I'd like to welcome everybody to the April 5th meeting of the Finance Committee here in South Deerfield, Massachusetts. I think we got not a full group, but everyone we're going to get, six out of the seven. Doug is just printing out a couple more budget summaries. And while we wait for that, I thought we would start with previous week's minutes. Did everybody have a copy, or does anyone need a copy? Do you need a copy, or you already took a look?
I took a look at it, but I do have a question.
Sure.
On the SCEMS item where the training one went from 7 to 17, mm-hmm. and he suggested it could be done cheaper by someone else rather than in-house, I thought about that, and I wasn't sure I understood why.
I think he said it covers more services than they'd be able to do in-house.
They don't have the people to do that training? Okay.
Yeah, well, I do
got
not.
A question on that same budget.
Sure.
What is this that they're doing for $17,000?
Well, in here it says education training, CQI, whatever that is, remediation services provided by Community 911 Training in Greenfield.
At the very end, it does say it's the answer there. Mm. The end of that paragraph. This all-inclusive amount actually covers more than we would be able to do ourselves in-house.
But what does it do?
Right, he's asking
what does it do? Who's doing it?
Well, it looks like the service out of Greenfield, and it's education and training for staff. I don't know more details than that.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's why I'm wondering, because
okay.
You don't know, I don't know, but they're going up $10,000 just for the hell of it. And to me, I'd like to know more about it.
Okay, hang on. Could I ask that we cover that when we get to the SCEMS budget,
okay,
and just revert this back to any questions about the minutes from last week, and then we can definitely talk about stuff like that. Any other questions on the minutes?
No. I make a motion we approve the minutes.
Thank you.
Second it.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Now, we're going to have a number of budgets to go through. I have a few handouts. What I'd love to start with is what Doug just left for me, which is... There's two for those guys, and then one more for Mary's right there. Doug, you have one, right? You don't need another handout?
No, I do not.
Okay. So, Doug, if I understand this correctly...
If you have a spare, I'll take it.
Oh, yeah, definitely. There you go.
For our friends from the press, that's a work in progress. Just so you know.
So, Doug, as I understand it, this is a budget representing, for any budgets that we have voted, those amounts. For any budget that we have not taken up, the recommended amounts.
Oh, good. He didn't pick up the comment about me killing him. Yes.
Okay. So basically, you know, and now let's see. So this is assuming, among all the different budgetary things that are listed, a transfer to stabilization of $100,000.
That's correct.
And would result in a free cash balance of, is that it in the back?
268,096.
So we'd have 268,000 in free cash, assuming a 100,000 transfer to stabilization and all the other things listed and included in here as requested, other than the things we voted on.
Correct.
So I don't want to spend too much time on this because we do have to go through more budgets, but I wanted to look over this just so that we can have an awareness of where we are from a big picture standpoint. The reality is everything requested, we literally do have the dollars for them, but that doesn't mean, you know, that still means we have to kind of go back over and be judicious with what we're spending and how we look at each of these budgets. And we have to think about, you know, where our priorities are in terms of free cash levels, stabilization levels, some of the other specific requests and warrants and budgets, you know, that all this is made up of.
Why do we have our entire free cash in here? I thought we're going to try and reserve at least $500,000.
Well, this is just the result of what the numbers look like now. To the extent that we want to target a free cash amount to set aside or have as a minimum, then that's going to inform some of what we do tonight in terms of how we vote some of these budgets. because right now there is not 500,000 set aside.
And that's why I'm bringing it up, because we've never put in the whole total amount. We've always reserved at least 500 or 600,000, and we've put in the net of it, but we've never put in the total budget figure. That's why I'm concerned.
What would you like to hold back?
Minimum 500,000. Or if you follow what they recommend is 5% of $14 million, $700,000. But it's up to the committee, not to me.
So just so we can, and again, Doug just says, this layout's a little new to me. This budget is assuming the use of $519,000 of free cash in order to fund slash balance this budget, as well as an additional $102,000.
It assumes the use of more free cash than what you just said.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's right. That was last year. It's a lot more than that.
Yeah.
Sorry.
1.417.
So right now we have $1.4 million of free cash going towards balancing this budget.
And unspent at the bottom is the 268.
Right. So yeah. Remaining unspent is 268, and then there's an additional 175,000 of free cash within the CIPC recommended capital projects.
Total use of free cash in the CIPC projects. The capital projects is $102,000. The rest is retained earnings from sewer or municipal building fund revenues.
Okay, so the difference there is the tractor that was pulled out of FY17 but not pulled out of the CIPC column. Is that why those,
correct.
That's why those are different?
Correct, okay. Yes.
All right. So we're using $1.4 million of free cash to fund the operational budget. We're using $102,000 of free cash to fund the capital requests that are where the revenue is coming out of appropriated funds. And that plus the rest of this budget would leave us with $268,000 in free cash. So that's kind of where we stand right now before we go through a number of these budgets, which may change these numbers.
Where do you see the 268,000?
On the very back, the very end of the last page. Which is tough because it's not labeled, that's why I asked, but it looks like.
So according to this, we're 268,000 to the good, assuming that we put all 1.4 million in there. Should be doing is saying we're minus 300 and something thousand rather than saying we're plus to the good. Because it looks like we got money to spend.
Well, and that's where you can see last year. It would seem to me that's what we did last year, is had a line item for free cash set aside that then the budget kind of trickled down towards a number closer to zero. Is that right, Doug? Is that why that is different?
I can certainly set aside for bookkeeping purposes or for planning purposes. I can set aside $700,000 in free cash. Mm-hmm. It leaves you with a deficit of $419,000. Mm-hmm. And I'll ask how you're going to balance that.
Right. So I guess the question I'd ask is, would you guys like to have a free cash conversation now, or would you like to go through some of these budgets, which may change these numbers, and have a free cash conversation then?
I think I was assuming that some of this discussion on the free cash would be tomorrow night in the joint meeting.
That's another good place to have it.
Because I know at least one of the selectmen has been talking about creating stabilization accounts for particular things.
Okay.
My concern is that the Finance Committee has always had a policy to try and start with maintaining 5% of the previous year's budget, and the selectmen have declined to agree to that because they use whatever they need to use. And in the end, the Finance Committee typically goes below the 5% mark, but I don't want to start at giving it all away and then saying, I want to fight to get 500,000 back.
Okay.
I would like to see at least 500,000 reserved at a minimum.
Doug, would you know if last year, and I know you weren't in the same role.
Go ahead.
If last year there was a free cash set aside that was inserted within the budget earlier in the process, because obviously right now we've just gone through the budget.
Sure.
Without one?
Going through both last year and this year, there was a free cash set aside.
Okay.
Last year's budget, we set aside, I want to say it was $700,000 at the beginning of it, and we tried to hold to that.
Yep.
That number got dropped down a little bit below that. And I believe for the most part, we held to that. It was around $400,000 when all was said and done at the end of the year, I think.
I recall.
I'm pushing my memory, but 400 and change, something like that. In starting the development of this budget, what I did is actually create a calculation in my spreadsheet that automatically determined 5% of the budget. So no matter what the budget was, as requests came in, 5% was calculated, and that 5% was the holdback on free cash. Mr. Pachorik is exactly right. It should be about $700,000, a little over $700,000, about $720,000, something like that, given the budget where it is, whatever the number turns out to be. About 3.5-4 weeks ago, that became untenable. There was no way to balance the budget with that much free cash being held back. For purposes of just finalizing the process, I removed the holdback to see where the numbers played out. And that's where we've gotten to where we are.
Okay.
I didn't feel at that point that I had the authority to proactively restrict budget requests.
I hear what John's saying, and I guess that raises a little bit of a concern for myself, too. Looking forward, if we do this with the 268, where does that leave us for next year?
Down the tubes.
Right.
Well,
you know, that's, I
guess, you with $268,000 that you'll carry over. As soon as July 1st hits, the 268 goes into a black hole, and we don't get to do anything with it until after it's recertified sometime in September.
Right.
At that point, the $268,000 will be added to whatever free cash is certified as being retained earnings, if you will, from FY16. Mm-hmm. And now the numbers are starting to come back to me. We held back about $500,000. Just under $500,000 last year. We let it drift off into that nebulous zone. We added to it about $900,000 of retained earnings from FY15 to make the total of $1.4 million in free cash that we've started with this year. Mm-hmm. So we're actually using free cash not just from retained earnings from FY16, but also from FY15. FY15 and FY14, really. 2 years worth of free cash.
So Doug, we're not using $1.4 million of free cash for this budget. That we have.
We're using
right
1.15
right.
or 1. Right. Some, yeah.
Right. 1.15. And that's, I think, considerably larger than the amount of free cash we used to balance last year's budget, isn't it?
Significantly larger.
Significantly.
That's very troubling.
Mm-hmm. Last year we had a 2.5% increase on our school, on Frontier Regional. I'm sorry, no, we had a 0% increase on Frontier Regional.
Right, right.
It was level funded, right. And we had only a 2.5% increase on Deerfield Elementary. Right. This year we are seeing larger increases, including the addition of a position at the police department, addition of staff at the library, and rolling in some other positions in the inspections department. We're also seeing more revenue coming in as well. All the inspection fees are being counted as revenue. All of the PEG access money is being counted as revenue. So that's helping to offset that.
Right. And you know, the reality is that the town is thankfully in a position where there will likely be a free cash build this year or after the end of this year as there was last year, but the risk is that we start to spend that before we even get it and set ourselves up for a point in time where those numbers don't keep coming in, and then you're really in a tough spot.
But John is right. I mean, we've talked about more than 500, but we've pretty much across the board said we need to hold 500. Last year, I think that was the goal. It did drift down into the 400s, I think, at the end, as I recall. And again, that's the fear. If things don't
fall
the way they should.
You know, with that number at 268, I think there is a path to get it towards, let's say, 500 as we did last year. And I think it'd be helpful to maybe start going through some of these budgets and noting where we're either recommending, you know, lower or higher amounts, and that's changing that 268 residual number, and see where we end up. And I think that tomorrow would be a good place to continue that conversation of, okay, requested budget leaves free cash of X, recommended finance committee recommended budget leaves free cash of Y. Now let's talk about those two numbers and then where those two numbers reside between stabilization, free cash, what sort of lines we're trying to draw to set aside money for future years.
Does anybody have an idea what the board's position has been traditionally on the free cash?
Selectmen?
Yeah.
They didn't have a position.
Right.
Okay. When I was on there, we talked about it several times, like almost every year,
mm-hmm.
And the position was that the Finance Committee is holding to their 5% rule, and that's enough. But the selectmen wanted the flexibility, so they never agreed to a percentage or a figure. So they're staying totally flexible on that. And I don't blame them either.
No, I understand. But they were kind of relying on the Finance Board to
hold the marker where it should be.
Yeah.
Because that's what our charge is.
So I'm just putting it on the table here so we hear the words.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, with that conversation, I think, looking at the budgets, the first one is selectman salary, so it's a perfect time to go into that one if we would like. Does anyone else have any other questions before we start going into these budgets? I sent around this list with everything on it. This is just kind of the order I'm going to work through things. And I have all the account numbers on there for you guys, and I'll read them out. First one is selectman salaries, $122,5100.
You've recommended $7,000.
We had, and it was up to 16. Is it back to 7, or is it still at 16?
The request is at 16.
I'm sorry?
The request is still at 16.
Okay.
That's fine.
What is fine?
Yeah, exactly. Having a difference between a requested amount and a recommended amount.
Okay, it's just it was changed to 16 after we voted it, so I just wanted to give everybody a chance to look at that change.
Yep.
It's changed.
So as Doug mentioned, we voted this. It was originally requested at 7,000 unchanged. We voted to recommend that. It was subsequently revised. The request was revised to 16,000, and I think, Doug, correct me if I'm wrong, some of the thinking was just trying to, obviously it's a lot of hours and work to do the position, and trying to potentially incentivize more people to want to do it.
That was the expectation, or that was the expressed reason for the increase. Yes.
Okay.
Exactly in those words.
And I'd throw up my opinion is I'd still feel that 7,000 is the right number, and you know, a lot of these jobs, and selectmen included, you're not getting paid to do them at 7 or 16. It's a lot of hours. It is a lot of responsibility. And there's not a lot of people getting into it as a career, for better or worse. And you know, that's kind of my position on the matter.
I agree on that. Yeah, I certainly wouldn't want to do the job for that kind of money. If you truly do the job the way it's supposed to be done, it's a horrendous amount of hours. And total here is so small compared to the whole town budget that
It's small, but again, that's where,
I know it all adds up.
It does add up.
I do understand that, but you asked for an opinion. I'm telling you, I'm agreeing with you that it's, not a huge $7,000 for a full year of all the meetings and all the state things they need to attend and so forth. And there's a lot of hours off from the job where I'm sure they're tackled with questions and.
Okay. So I'm sorry, are you in favor of the 7,000 or the 16,000?
Oh, I'm looking. 16. No.
Okay.
I'm in favor of the 7. With the budget and that, I just can't see, 130 or 128% raise.
Yeah.
And I understand everything that's involved, but I just can't justify it at this point in time.
The selectman's salary was designed to be a stipend. And if you figure out what you get, you probably get 12 or 14 cents per hour when you get through. But that's the way it was designed. Mm-hmm. And anybody that isn't up for that challenge for doing the work for nothing, then c'est la vie. That's the way it goes sometime. Me, I would leave it at 7,000. Last time they got a raise was when I got out of being a selectman. And the only reason we gave him a raise was because I made the motion to give him a raise, because they always say no. Selectmen always say no, no matter what. So I turned around and they said, well, you can't vote on it. I said, why not? I said, I'm getting out of office, so it ain't going to affect me, so I can vote on it.
Question, Doug, did the selectmen put this in there, or you did?
That was that number was adjusted at the request of one of the selectmen.
And it was adjusted to how much?
17.
The salaries went from $2,500 for the chair and $2,250 for the members to $6,000 for the chair and $5,000 for the members.
I guess what I'm struggling with is you have a huge number of people that are volunteering for various committees throughout this town that are receiving nothing for a stipend. They're just volunteering their time and trying to do what's best for the town. So to do a 128% increase, and not to do anything for everybody else, I really struggle with that, because a lot of these committees put in a lot of hours also, and they get hit up on the street too. So I guess that's what I'm struggling with.
For me, I think that increasing that is only a need to have, to the extent that you literally aren't getting people to run for the positions, and maybe that's a way to incentivize people to want to do that. But you know, we have two select seats up, and there's multiple people running for each one, and I don't think anybody got into it because they heard that they might increase the stipend.
I'm sure they didn't.
So I think that, you know, for me, then it's a nice to have, because I do think it is a lot of work, but I don't think we do not have money this year for nice to haves. That's how I feel.
We either leave it at 7, or if you want to feel generous, you could give them a raise of $200 each or something, and that's it. I'd say leave it.
I think I'd prefer just to leave it, unless there's strong support to change it.
If we're looking at the budgets with the idea of retrieving some funds to go back to free cash, we can't slip by the top one here.
Right.
And, you know, I go along with the fact that, you know, they probably spend the $2,500 just in gas for the different meetings and stuff they go to. So I feel very strongly that that is definitely not needed. But if we raise the selectman salaries, we're going to have to raise the assessor salaries.
That's right.
Because they always go tandem.
Just a point of clarification. When you were saying 7, I was thinking 16. I had just looked quickly at the per person, and I thought you were talking about the per person, Dylan. Okay.
No worries. That's but why I wasn't sure.
Yeah. I hadn't bothered with the finite detail. However, still stand by what I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. And I guess I thought that because when I originally had seen it was $2,500 a year, it was almost laughable. Because why even bother to pay them at all? You know, it seems so ridiculous. But whatever the case.
So what do you want to do? You want to cut them?
Do we need?
Pardon me?
Do you want to cut them?
Doug, if we're looking to stay at 7, do we even need to vote it? Because that is what we voted previously.
That's your vote on February 2nd.
So unless somebody wants to change it, then we can move on. I just want to bring it up as the request had changed. We're going to stay at 7,000. Yep. Okay. The next one is...
John, I believe in the committee. If the group wants to go that way, I have no problem with
it. I do too.
I don't need a thumbs up on we won. That was not the purpose. I always work as a committee person, and I will go along with the committee. Okay.
Okay. Next budget is selectman staff salaries, 122,5100. I'm not intending to vote this one tonight, but we haven't really talked about it, and I wanted Doug to just give us a quick overview of what the pieces are, what any moving parts are, so that we will know. Maybe this will come up tomorrow night or next week again. So Doug, could you take us through this really quick?
Sure.
So this is 122,5100.
Yep.
Or sorry, 5110. 122,5110.
What are we talking about?
Selectmen staff salaries.
Okay. What was the total? Oh, okay.
The selectman staff salaries consist of basically everybody who works in that little office right there. It also includes, as of a year or two ago, the town administrator salary, which previously had been broken out. That's included in this budget as well. The staff that are there, and I should point out, if you're looking at the budget sheet, the administrative assistant line, you'll notice it was not funded in 2016 nor in 2017. That is the position that moved from that office to the inspections office. Mm-hmm. And so it's the same money, it just appears in somebody else's budget. But that's why it's no longer there. The executive assistant is funded at a grade three, step one, which is the bottom of the grade. That position is the one that I had been doing until I was appointed as interim town administrator. That has been reset down to grade three, step one. The administrative assistant is...
That first role is the one that you would be... that is being filled by...
It is not filled at this point.
Okay.
The administrative assistant is Pat Kroll's position. That's a step increase for that position. I believe it's a step increase. It does add up to a step increase, yes. That position is currently under review for classification, and so where it was at G2 step 8, it will likely go to G3 step 6 G3 step 6 is the same as G2 step 9. It's the same dollar amount, I believe. I am going to quickly check that to make sure I'm not confusing people.
And what is the purpose of the reclassification from G2 to G3?
It's a reconsideration of the duties of the position. The position is being compared by the personnel committee to the administrative assistant in the police department. They looked at the educational requirements, the duties, the day-to-day tasks, as well as the tasks that the person has been asked to do in addition, above and beyond. And the administrative assistant of the police department is a grade 3 position. And so I believe that the, and please help me out if I'm wrong, Mary, but I believe the determination of the personnel board is strongly leaning towards reclassifying this to grade 3.
Okay.
And therefore I've just adjusted it so the step increase is exactly what it would be if it were not reclassified.
What basically happened was the police clerk was hired before the personnel board was in action, basically. And it came in as grade 3, and they gave her a couple extra steps. So we felt that when we reviewed the the different qualifications needed, administrative assistant for the selectman's office had a lot more requirements for it than the police department did. So we felt it was only fair to bring her to the same level, or that position to the same level, not necessarily clerk. Who's there?
Will that affect any other positions in town office? Were there other ones under review, or just the one?
Under review is the accountants also, I believe.
Okay.
But I had to leave early, so I think this was the only one we talked about.
Well, the meeting last night was postponed anyways. I think it has it.
We didn't have a meeting last night.
Right. Was it
snowed.
Rescheduled? Do you know? Next Monday?
I don't know. We haven't decided.
Oh, okay. All right. No. There we go.
Okay. And then there's the committee clerk.
The committee clerk is a position that I've put in there as a placeholder. That position is not filled. It would be a new position. The committee clerk I envision as being someone who would attend Board of Selectmen's meetings and planning board meetings. This person would act as a liaison between the planning board and the Board of Selectmen, but also act as the administrative support for the planning board. That's a position that up to this point the administrative assistant or the executive assistant has done. Committee clerk would also act as a de facto public records person, helping to coordinate all the records for the planning board, the Board of Selectmen, as well as the administrator's office, would help to work towards a digital record storage, basically scanning our old back records, consolidating them, helping to organize records in a manner that can either be immediately publicly accessible by anyone who wanted to do a record search, or more easily accessible to staff at the very least. I envision this as a very part-time position, 12 to 15 hours. That being said, and this is why I was a little reluctant to put this in, there was some discussion about the possibility of, and maybe it's too early to talk about, there's been some discussion about the possibility of creating a part-time position of town planner, someone who would be a planning board liaison, but also be a stronger assistant to the work of the planning board. This person also could be a default grant writer, looking for grant opportunities at the federal and state level to either develop town resources or provide resources to private industry to help to grow the commerce of the town. That's extremely speculative. That's not there.
Okay.
What I do know is that this committee clerk would be able to fulfill the public records requests that we're going to be getting in, would be focusing tightly on zoning law, and most importantly, the changes happening to zoning law, which are under review at the state level. I don't know if you've heard anything about that, but that's happening. And would help the planning board transition from our current zoning regulations in help to revise those into regulations that would comply with the new zoning law being considered at the state level.
it's kind of an all-around position, but with a strong focus on planning, on zoning regulations, and could possibly morph into a administrative support for the ZBA and or CONCOM as well. So,
all right, and you know, this is some of this stuff is still kind of moving around. So I think your preference as well would be to not vote this, but just kind of discuss and, right. and pick it back up next week. You know, from my standpoint, I remember last year when the position was moved over from the select staffs to the inspections. Mm-hmm. I distinctly remember being told it was not going to be backfilled and replaced, so there would not be a net additional cost to town government. And there wasn't last year, but now it seems to be coming back. And so I understand how much work you guys do and how you could use all the help you can get. And I'm very open to more conversation over the next week to get more details and see where this ends up. But I'm going to have a tough time. And again, just echoing what I think is going to come up over and over again this session, it's tough to see that expansion here in this budget year. But
I would like to point out the bottom line. 153,941 represents about a $1,500 increase over the 2011 budget for this department. And in 2011, there was 4 staff people there at that time.
Right, and I appreciate that. And it's just, you know, we can't, some budget, not every budget is going to be able to be flat or only up 2%. So when there's budgets that we can save money, we need to save money. And like I said, I'm very empathetic to the hours that you guys have to put in to handle all the things that you have. I'm very glad you have been able to add somebody. Kat, which I guess she would be or is or will be the exec admin assistant.
It's going to have to be publicly posted if we're okay. going to fill that with somebody else.
Sorry, I don't know the
problem. Yeah. If the Board of Selectmen choose to go out to post for that position,
right.
then that's really cool.
Yeah.
But if they also decide to go out for a full-time town administrator and they hire somebody else, I'm out of a job. So,
right.
yeah, I'm in a weird place, and I'm not sure I can even, within the bounds of ethical responsibility, whether I can even adjudicate on any of these matters.
Okay.
But I do expect that in the position she's in right now, if she's still there as of July 1, that Kat's hours will increase. Mm-hmm. But she's currently at a grade 1, step 1.
Okay.
I would want to increase her to a higher grade, still at step 1, because she's doing more work. She's being responsible for more information in the office. And I would expect to add to her workload as much as possible.
Right. And that's where I think that position makes sense, whether it's her or somebody else. And, you know, I understand that what she may be paid or whoever may be paid those first few months may not be exactly grade 3, step 1. But I don't want to try to skinny the administrator and the exec administrative assistant down when we don't know exactly who's going to be in them or what they're going to be making. I think what you have here makes sense. It's really just that other position that, you know, that's how I feel about that. But does anyone else have any questions now, knowing that we're going to come back to this? I just wanted to give an overview as we had not discussed this before. Okay. The next one is accountant salary, 135,51,10. And this is a fairly straightforward budget of just one line item. And the issue, I think we talked about it before, the position was, you know, due for a step raise as others, and Doug has done some work and looked at some comparative pay for other accountant services in towns around ours and is recommending a 4-step increase for that position.
How does that fall within line with other towns?
Well, we did a broader assessment of salaries for town accountants, and we looked at a lot of different towns, but we realized pretty quickly that it was an unfair comparison, because in some cases, some towns use services from the Council of Governments, and those salaries are inordinately high. They're in the $50 and $60 range, because you're paying not only for the hourly rate for the person, but also the entire benefits as the COG estimates them to be, plus an additional administrative fee on top of that. So to pay $65 or $70 for an accountant is pretty ridiculous. So what I did with Kat's assistance today, I made phone calls to Irving, Greenfield, Montague, Northfield, and Rowe, all of whom have their own accountant on staff. We looked at the number of hours. We looked at the budget for the town.
We looked at the hours per week worked by the accountant, whether or not they have additional staff. And then we looked, of course, at the salary and the how that broke out to an hourly wage for that person. Really, really quickly checking this. 37. Okay. So Montague, Greenfield, and Irving all were at the top of the list, with Montague giving us a with an annual budget of about $19.8 million. So it's a little higher than ours by about 30%. But they have an accountant that works 35 hours a week, and the range is $30 to $37 an hour, or $55,000 to $68,000 per year. Greenfield has an accountant, full-time CPA, but also a payroll clerk and an AP, accounts payable clerk. The accountant has a salary of between $65,000 and $80,000 per year. So that adds up to somewhere around $37.80 per hour for their accountant as being paid right now. They have a payroll clerk and an AP clerk, both of which work between 30 and 37 hours, and they're paid between $16 and $21 an hour. Rough numbers dropping off the cents. Northfield has a 20-hour-a-week accountant that they pay $27 an hour, and Rowe has an 8-hour-a-week accountant that they pay about $38 an hour. I also checked with the town of Hatfield. Hatfield was, I think, 20 hours a week, and the rate was at about $29 an hour. So the closest analog I could find was Northfield. A budget of about $8 million. Their accountant works about 20 hours a week. Their accountant is not a CPA, and they're paying about $27 an hour.
Does that person have benefits?
At 20 hours a week, I doubt it. All the rest do, based on the number of hours they work per week, with the exception of Roe.
And I guess that's the tough thing. Like and thank you for getting that data. That was very helpful. I kind of threw out Greenfield and Roe just because they seem different, but I thought that Montague, Irving, and Northfield were all very good comps. And with Irving and Northfield, they were paying higher hourly rates, but for fewer hours, and so actually spending a lot less per year. And you know, I think that's where it's kind of a two-sided thing. There's both the hourly rate and how many hours you're paying them to do the work. And I think Brenda does a great job, and I think that we do need this position, and I think that it is much more expensive if you end up going through the COG. But I think that's the tough thing here, is going up to, you know, matching someone's rate that's only paying for 8 hours a week and we're paying benefits. That's tough. I don't know if that's apples to apples.
I think it is. Yeah.
Definitely not.
Because it's, you know, the benefits are at
37%.
You add that to the 26.
Sure.
But what did you say, John? I missed that.
He said definitely not.
I couldn't hear it. Yeah.
Did this, I like I said, I missed part of the meeting last week, but did this go to the personnel board?
Not yet.
Okay.
Maybe we should pass on it and let them.
Well, I think that regardless of what they came back with steps, and Doug, correct me if I'm wrong, that would point to some budget number, which we still could recommend that or something else. So obviously their input is valued and an important part of this process. But if we do have opinions, basically this is we either support 1, 2, 3, or 4 step increase. 4 is seems to be the highest it's going to be. 1, it's going to be at a minimum, or something in between. That's kind of how I look at it. You know, for myself, and I said this the first time we talked about it, I have a hard time going away from a classification schedule that we know is flawed and we know has not been revised in time to update anybody and everybody's position and schedule and steps this year. That said, it does seem to be far enough away that I'm willing to go more than one step. You know, in my head coming into tonight, I was thinking about a two-step increase, because I do want to demonstrate to the person in this position that they are important to us, and we do recognize the reality of the competitive landscape out there. 4 steps gets tough for me because there's a number of other positions based on that same study that showed we're paying well more than the average cohorts, and nobody on this committee or elsewhere is recommending them be decreased steps or decreased hours or decreased something. And so that's where, to me, if it's going to be a one-way ratchet, we need to be judicious with how we ratchet.
I kind of agree with Dylan. I'm thinking maybe with the two steps, with the benefits that the other towns aren't paying, would be I think would be pretty realistic. That's just my own opinion. I could be off, but I'm just thinking.
I think both of you guys are right on track. That's what we should be doing. We can always go up again next year in addition to that.
Right.
Because like you said, we're not going to go backwards and ask for somebody to cut their pay.
On top of which, next year we'll hopefully have a revised classification schedule and approach to looking at these types of decisions, which will be across the board, not just one or two that seem to be sticking out, and try to fix the squeaky wheel. Not that the person in the position is a squeaky wheel, but just from a number standpoint that they stick out.
We're going to hold this until next week anyway, or no?
I mean, if we have some consensus around what we're thinking now, we can vote something now, or we can just hold off, because I think Doug may have to calculate the numbers anyway rather than do that on the wire.
2 seconds.
Okay. What would you prefer, Doug? Would you like us to vote an amount now, or would you like us to hold off?
You can do it as you will. It's up to you.
If you can get the numbers in a couple of seconds, let's just vote it.
All right. Could you calculate that salary line item for a two-step increase?
376,47.
376,47, which is a two-step increase.
That's your recommendation?
Well, would anyone like to make a motion to recommend that amount?
So move.
Have a second?
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. How many was that, actually? 1, 2, 3, 4. Opposed? And abstaining?
I'm abstaining.
Okay, so it carries 4-1-1.
I think we're shotgun.
I want to just say this. I do appreciate the role of the Finance Committee, and I certainly respect the opinions of the people at the table, and I certainly respect the manner by which the Finance Committee operates to advise town meeting. I will be standing up at town meeting and fighting for the higher number.
I hope you do. That this is what I think
and, with all due respect to the committee, and it's not something I'm going to do for every difference of opinion, certainly.
Right.
In this case, I know the work that our accountant does, and I know that if there's another position that opens up somewhere else at $37 an hour, she will likely go. And I would certainly encourage her to do so. We will have a hard time finding someone to replace her if that comes. So
I agree that's a risk. I don't take lightly not going the 4 steps you're requesting. So thank you, and I look forward to that conversation. I think that's the good side of town meeting, is when we have clear options and can present them to the town, and the town can decide. Okay. The next budget is legal expense, 151-51-10. I believe this was one we did vote before.
February 9.
And it changed.
Did it?
That's what I had in my notes, if that is incorrect.
What did you have for an amount?
Let's see.
It was like 25?
28, 150.
Was it 25 and change, or 26 and change, or something like that?
28,150.
28,150.
So I had us having voted 27,500. Did we vote it again since then?
I think so.
Well, that's what's in the budget here. I looked at Doug's spreadsheet when we voted on Feb 9, which is the only time I knew us to have voted this. We voted 27,500. I'm looking at this.
No, fair enough. After looking at that, I did make some slight reductions. To the actual legal expense to bring the request down to 27.5.
Oh, okay.
If that's what you voted, then that's fine. The difference was, $1,500 or something like that?
It was $650. I don't know what it changed.
$650, that's fair enough.
So 27.5
can stand, and I've reduced the request to that. The most important thing is that it's more than $20,000. I checked with Brenda this afternoon, and we're already at that amount.
Right.
We're at $20,000. I expect to have to go out, because our appropriation for FY16 was $20,000. I expect to have to go for a reserve fund transfer because I'm still expecting a pretty significant bill related to an appeal to a zoning board decision, and we haven't paid town's council for the review of the town warrants or her presence at the annual town meeting.
Okay.
So we're going to see another $3,000 to $5,000 at least over the course of this year.
And as a refresher, because we talked about this the last time, I think we all agreed it looked like FY16 was unduly cut down to 20 more for you know, making the budget look a certain way, not because that, right. that's what we thought we would spend.
Right.
So while this does look like a large percentage and dollar increase, or large percent, decent dollar increase, I think it was last year that was the poor budget, not this one.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
Okay, that one we don't need to vote then because it has been changed.
So I appreciate that. Thank you.
No problem. The next one is contracted services, budget number 159-5410. And the main change to this one, it is significantly higher. We had voted $86,150 back in February. It is now, I see, Doug, $173,500.
Correct.
The majority of that increase is due to the PEG funding, or PEG expenses, rather, being added to this budget.
Yep. We put in a line item for PEG services. I think I've already given you guys this spiel, haven't I?
Yes.
Maybe I haven't. Okay. it's $77,000 that's here as an expense, but it's $77,000. Actually, I think it's more like $80,000 that's on the other side, on the revenue side.
And local receipts.
It's right. basically just publishing the money that's coming in and going out, whereas before it never appeared on the budget. So the additional increases to this expense are about $1,000 more for our broadband connection. This is because so much of what we do relies on online services that we're seeing significant slowdowns at certain times during the day because we just don't have a pipe big enough for our data to move through it. There's $150 more for our email account. Hey, how would you like a gift? I'm going to drop that right now to $850. The email account, because we just paid for email services and they're good for 2 years.
Okay.
So as long as you folks agree that we can keep it at $850 this year, we aren't going to spend it, but we'll have it at $850 for fiscal year 2019, and we're going to spend about $1,700 at that point.
Hmm.
I don't know if that's the right way to do it. If you'd like, I'll zero it out, just with the understanding that in 2 years' time, we're going to need to have about $1,700 there.
If it's $17 every 2 years, I think $850 per year is the right way to do it.
What line are we talking about?
And kind of take that both ways because it's going to flush
maybe
back
it's
out.
Not. So honestly,
you're going to be over and then under and then over and then under. So
I'm happy to zero that out for FY17. FY17, we won't need it.
Yeah.
So
okay.
There's that.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? Put it down to what?
Zero. How about that?
Zero.
We've already
account.
Paid for our email services for the next 2 years, so it will be March of 2018. That we'll have to renew, and that cost will be about $1,700 or $1,800. So that won't come on until FY18's budget.
Right. Okay.
March of 2018? That'll be in the 17 budget.
No, that'll be FY18.
Yeah. Not next March, two Marches, right?
Well, that's in...
Yeah, don't gain a year.
2018 is when the bill will come?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
That's when we'll need to renew.
Sorry.
Yep. So let me just really quickly check...
So what's the total appropriated then?
That. So the total appropriated now at the bottom will be 171,850. That represents an increase of 77,591 over last year, of which 77,000 is the PEG access.
Okay.
So, whew, that was easy.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the appropriated number again? I missed that.
The total number at the bottom line, the request is 171.
Yep.
850.
Okay. So, you know, this is one that may look scary at first blush because it'll have a large percent increase or number, but as Doug said, there's corresponding revenue, so this budget is very consistent year over year.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's smart to take out the email account based on how we're doing that.
Saving money.
You want a motion?
Yeah.
I'll move.
Wait a second. Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Okay. I'm glad we looked at that. We saved $1,500.
Okay, next one is police payroll, 210-5110. 210-5110. We had discussed this, a couple months ago now, or a month and change ago now. At the time, it was unknown what was going to become of the school resource officer from a budget standpoint, so it was not included in this budget. This budget you should have now reflects that position being funded. And then, Doug, correct me if I'm wrong, there were two other line items that were adjusted up that are directly related to your staffing levels. So as your staff increases, those did as well, which
were
Quinnville and overtime pay.
And as I mentioned in the email to you, Dylan, but for everybody else, the Quinn bill, of course, was established back in, I think, the early 70s. It's no longer in practice except as a holdover. Those who were eligible at the time that it was no longer funded by the state, which was 6, 8, 10 years ago, continue to receive those benefits. Officers who transfer in from another department that were receiving the Quinn bill at that other department are paid the town's portion only, or roughly 50% of what the Quinn bill requires. Officers who are coming on the force new are offered an educational stipend, and that's based on whether they have an associate's degree or a bachelor's degree or a master's degree. And so that Quinn bill line item basically refers to the money that's paid out for all of those various things. So. Okay.
And then over time, as those people retire, this number at the town level should go to zero, because then it would be picked up at the state.
Well, it won't go to zero.
Not to zero, but to
it'll be used only for the educational
right
stipend.
Sorry. Right.
The educational bonus.
Okay. So this is, you know, has been a fairly controversial issue throughout the course of the budget season with the school resource officer. And so I guess I'll throw out my opinion to start, and then people can go from there or counter or agree with it. I don't know. I've never served in a police force, and I've never worked or been an administrator for a school, so I do not know the exact needs of a school resource officer. As I stand back, I kind of see us as just watching these two entities, the school and the police, come together to bring forth this position that is joint between them in terms of communication responsibility and funding. This position, as it's been described in the budget this year, is not that. The school, in every meeting we were at, did not support the position in the way it was drawn up and has not set aside money in their budget for it. For that reason, I don't support this, because I view it as just adding another police officer, which certainly will be used towards the school, and that is a good thing. However, that's not, to me, what a school resource officer in its essence is. It would be collaborative between the school and the police, and we haven't seen it yet. I know that Marty and some of the other school officials have said that this came kind of late in their budget process, and I think that's unfortunate, and perhaps if that had started sooner, we could have ended up in a different place. But unfortunately, that leaves me personally feeling that this should be withheld this year and let them do that work, and if they come back in FY18 with an actual collaborative effort, then that is something I could support at that point in time. What do you guys think?
I don't know where I got this impression, but it was not a multiple choice with the state. They basically
mandated
it.
It is mandated by Mass General law.
Right.
However, it is an unfunded mandate.
Right. So they can't.
And towns and school districts can opt out.
Right.
At their own choosing.
They've had a resource officer.
Right. So they've had an officer who has been the point of contact with the schools, which makes a ton of sense, and has been consistently interacting with the schools, which makes a ton of sense. I also I can appreciate that strains the resources of the police force, both in terms of manpower and scheduling. And so I do agree that something needs to be done, but this to me is a very tough solution of just expanding it on the town side with the school not in the same place, I guess.
That individual's pay was from the police department then, the one that filled in there.
Right.
The one you just referenced.
Right, so the person who's actually, as I understand, the person performing the school resource officer duties is not the one listed as school resource officer line item.
I mean, it was just pulled from the department, that's all.
Right.
But ultimately, the police department's budget paid for that work done up there.
You mean so far this year?
No.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, they've been funding whatever work they've been doing out of their salary and their salary budget.
But this is just identifying it now.
Right.
The chief gave sort of the impression that about 2/3 of this came to him from the private school. Now, there's no mandate or... I don't know that was the case. I don't know how many.
They did.
Superintendent inferred that she didn't see him that often at her school. So I don't. There's something. Yeah.
Well, and that's the thing. The private schools had shown. I wasn't there for all the conversations, but I believe it was Deerfield Academy alone. Maybe it was all of them. I don't know. Had put forth money that's already been sent in, that is sitting there for this position to be used. And so I do think, again, that is part of the collaborative effort we need to make happen.
Yep.
And that I do support, but so far in the FY17 budget, Frontier and DES do not seem to be part of that collaborative
right.
effort.
I agree. They since they're not...
And I'm not blaming them. I'm saying that's right. just the facts of the right. case.
I think you're right, Bill. I heard that too.
So, you know, maybe we do a part-time resource officer, and whoever's paying gets the use of that part-time hours. I don't know. I mean, I don't. If the regional school doesn't apparently see any benefit, then
you're looking for clarification, though, really, of the whole.
Well, the grammar school, the vice principal is their discipline person, right? That's what the vice principal normally did.
Yeah.
I believe that's still the case, yeah. yeah.
In the grammar school. I don't know what the vice principal at the high school does, but I know I've heard in the past that it used to be. I don't know if it still is or not.
But we're not in a position.
Should we put this off till tomorrow night and talk with the selectmen a little bit about this? Because last I heard that the private schools put up $30,000 for this position.
Right.
The selectmen were mm-hmm. willing to pay the benefits. The town paid the benefits.
Personally? That would be great.
The town.
Yeah, the town.
Pay the benefits of the position. And we're hoping that the two schools would step forward with some dollars. Now, I don't know where that went, and I don't. That was last I heard, Doug. Is that somewhat of a correct assessment or no? Should we wait till tomorrow?
There is $30,000 in an account from one of the private schools made as a gift to the town specifically to fund this.
Mm-hmm.
The Board of Selectmen did say that they felt that it was an important position to have funded, that it was important to keep it in place. While there is, there's been, you know, concern about whether or not the schools were able to contribute a certain portion of money, that didn't happen this year. Conversations with both the current superintendent as well as the principals, the principal and vice principal, Darius Modesto and Scott Dredge, anyway, at the schools, both feel that the presence of the current person who's doing the school resource officer has been a tremendous asset to the school, to Frontier Regional. There was some, I won't say negativity, but maybe sort of apathy about the presence of a school officer at the elementary school, but in amongst the leadership at the regional school, they definitely see the benefit of having the officer there. The police chief has spoken to me personally about what that officer has been able to achieve, particularly in a couple of recent incidents where having his presence at the school has been a tremendous asset, not just to the school community, but also to the police force as they were trying to do their job in relation to some incidents that happened recently. I believe that, I personally believe this should be funded. I think it's a necessity. I think it's an important component of community policing. I come from a background where I was at Turner's Falls High School, and Brown, what was his name? I can't think of his first name off the top of my head. Anyway, a police officer from the Montague PD was a school resource officer there full-time through the for the middle and high school, and he formed relationships with students. He created bonds with those students, and that opened those students up to feel like they could talk to him, not about, you know, what some kid was doing, but sometimes just about how their lives were going. Sometimes having that kind of presence, someone who's in a strong, positive community figure, able to talk to a student, can help to prevent problems later on. Doug Brown was his name. How could I forget his first name? And what Officer Brown was able to do there was seen on a daily basis. I think that's what the chief is trying to do here, and I think that this can be supported. If you take a look at the increase at the bottom of the budget, we're looking at an increase of $52,000. Seems pretty big, but $30,000 of that is already in the box. It's already being paid for. So really, you're looking at an increase of about $22,000, or roughly about, what does that turn out to be, about 2.5-3%. I think if my math is correct.
But all in all, this is an additional officer that we're looking at, because we have one already.
Right, so my understanding is that the shifts that the person interacting with the schools had been on had been backfilled with per diem part-time officers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so those are the shifts that this new officer would be taking. Mm-hmm. Doug, thanks for that backdrop, and I do agree with a lot of what you're saying. Again, for me, I did hear fairly specifically a few times in public, you know, situations or public meetings that, you know, certain people in the school did not support. And my concern is that if you have elements of school leadership not supporting this, my concern is that it won't work. Because I think that collaboration is vital. That said, I'm still open to this conversation. I think we should continue it tomorrow night. I think it's a very good topic. I think Jeff had a very good idea there.
A moment ago, I said, I think what you people are looking for is clarification. We just kind of blew over that, but this is exactly what I meant. There's like some substance to it, but we can't quite get our hands on it. About the funding and the $30,000 maybe that's coming in, it's not highly defined. But I 100% agree with what Doug's saying, and I made the point before, and I won't go back through it again, but at Franklin County Trade, I see what that individual's accomplished up there, and it's tremendous. I mean, it's really, really a good position, but how it's funded or identifying that needs to be clear, I think.
The resource officer that they have now is very well respected. Mm-hmm. The kids like him very much.
I'm not saying he isn't, no.
Right, but it's just that now we're adding another officer is more.
And that's why I say,
we are
looking for clarification.
Well, I do agree that it's great to have people that kids in schools, grammar or high school, can form relationships with. We have an entire staff of school people who do that as well. Mm-hmm. So this isn't about like not wanting kids to have people to go to. They have people to go to. They could always have more people to go to. So again, I think a lot of good points raised, and I think we can continue that conversation tomorrow night if people think that's a good idea.
I think Dylan brings up a good point too of, we have heard from Marty and a few of the others as far as a little hesitation here, as far as, you know, the scope of the position and what they'd be doing in the buildings and that. And it'd be awful nice if there is some way that the chief and the school officials could get together and have a discussion to see if they could get behind the effort here or not. You know, and yeah. try to add a little clarification, so it provide us as a committee a little more direction as far as looking at this budget.
Well, that's exactly the clarification I was speaking about. Is to clarify the whole facts, the substance around the whole thing, not just money, but.
I'd like to read a portion of an email sent to me from Marty Barrett from this past Friday, Friday 5:17. A.M.? No, that can't be right. I think the time is off. And she's probably up at that point. I know I wasn't. I'm paraphrasing a little bit of this. She said that had I been informed that this position, the school resource officer, was that they were looking for funding at the beginning of the budget process, say last winter, she might have had the latitude to support the position. But to come in at the 11th hour is not something that she was able to do. Then she goes on to say, yesterday we had our four-town safety meeting, which is where the chief informed me of this possibility. The school resource officer, and she says, our SRO, Brian Ravish, was also present. They both know that I support the position and that it is nothing personal, and that I would recommend that next year some funding be added to the budget to support the position. So she makes it very clear she supports the role of the SRO, but the fact is the request for funding came in too late at the public hearing instead of in December or November or January, where there could have been some wiggle room. So.
Okay. Well, I still think tomorrow would be a good place to have this conversation, maybe get some additional perspective from,
I agree,
whether it's Marty or whoever. Yes.
Just want to make one comment. I've not talked about the police payroll budget. I will not talk about it because that's conflict of interest. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to request a note be put in there that I abstain from any and all discussion on this budget.
Mm-hmm. We will, and that's appreciated. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
That's called CYA.
Mm. I don't think you always did that. When you were young, you...
Okay. With that, then, we will move on to some school budgets, I guess, staying on topic of sorts. First one, Deerfield Elementary, budget number 300-5400.
Do you have 2.47%? Is that what you have in that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
4469223.
Yep.
So, what do people think about this budget? How would you like to? We can talk big picture. We can talk about something specific. I'd like to not go through weeds of a ton of line items. We kind of had our chance to do that. If there's something specific that you feel strongly about, that's great. Otherwise, you know, try to keep it higher level.
The only thing that I was questioning at all was the addition of the additional IT person. They said it was part of the instruction and teaching the teachers how to do the whiteboards. Now they have teacher classes and stuff every week, right?
As far as like a professional development?
Right. So my question is, this is basically bringing another person on board. And it's maybe starting as part-time, but it's going to increase. That's my fear.
No.
So let's see, just to be clear, make sure we're talking about the same thing. You're speaking
about
the...
They have an IT person.
The $21,000
Yes, $92.
Increase.
I appreciate that they've been trying to keep everything down, and they did a really good job at that, considering most of it was salaries. But to bring on another position in that, you know, for training the teachers is the way she spoke about it when we discussed it. And I had it in my notes when I was reviewing it. I don't know where it is in the line item.
Yeah, I'm just trying to find it just so we, you know, we're on the same thing here. Anyone else have any thoughts on that?
Can't find it now. I had it in my notes about the person. In the front page, that's the increase in the budget. That's what it represents.
You say the
21.92.
Well, the 21.092, I don't believe is salaries. I believe that's expenses related to technology investments. That's my recollection of that budget line item. Because all the salary-related costs are at the top.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, I read it. I have it in my notes that I read that it was for teaching the teachers. It's part of the increase.
Yeah, there's
because they have regular person who takes care of day-to-day expenses for the classroom and for the students and whatever.
Yep.
And then they wanted to add an additional amount for teaching the teachers how to use the whiteboards and so on and so forth.
Right, and then they changed the funding formula for that because they found that because Deerfield has more teachers, they're spending more time in Deerfield than, say, some of the other elementary schools because it's one position that covers... All the grammar schools, right?
Okay. Mm. Oh, all the grammar schools.
Yes.
I must have misunderstood it. I just made a note of that.
Because I think what that is, that's the increase in allocation of instructional tech integration. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to caveat that I'm not 100% sure on this, but I believe that was the line item related to that position. Mm-hmm. And then down in operational increases, you have the increase of 21,092, which deals with investments that I believe that person, but maybe not just that person, is making for the different school systems, IT,
the
hardware
white, the
and needs and servers
like
and whatever else. Yeah, the one thing on this budget is kind of related to this that I had mentioned before was the there was an increase of $8,900 for the tablet leasing, which followed a form that I've noticed in a number of budgets this year, not just school, where a line item is expended in 1 year, and then the next year, it's given its own line item and broken out as its own expense, but then wherever it was funded the year before isn't reduced.
Right.
And I've seen that over and over and over again.
That's kind of what I was getting to.
Yeah. And so that $8,900 to me, I believe they said they took that out of textbooks. And if their determination is to invest in tablets because they have enough and they don't need to buy as many textbooks, hey, good for them. That's why we love have them to make those decisions. But if they're reallocating their resources, it's a reallocation, not a stealth increase by just giving it its own lineup next year. So if I had any, recommendation or changes on this budget, I know it's not a lot of money, but that $8,900 is the one that kind of jumped out at me.
Well, that was on the same line of what I was looking at.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Anyone else feel strongly about reducing that amount, leaving that amount, talking about a different line item, or comfortable with this budget overall? I mean, it's difficult in the big picture because this is, we're in a phase right now at the elementary school. We're actually reducing a class per year. And maybe we will reverse course if demographics change. But last year and this year we are, and still we're having, you know, decent size increase in the budget. And I understand there's a lot of these costs are difficult to contain, but that's the same challenge that the town is facing. And so I think we have to look at it with a similar lens.
There needs to be a kumbaya with everyone in town and all the administrators, and we all get realization that we're in a tight spot and we're not going to grow for a while, and we need to actually stop spending some of this money. And I think everyone's trying to do their own little budget line, slip it in there, and I don't know how to stop it.
Well, the fact that we're dropping two classes, two of them, right? The two.
One last year and then one this year.
Yeah. That didn't really change much in instruction, did it?
Well, they're dropping, you know, there's a reduction in staffing, right? So there's one through attrition that's being reduced. Again, we don't know if they'll continue to do that for the next few years as that two-class grade goes through. But, you know, just the thing that concerns me about, you know, future budgets is we're not able to keep this closer to, you know, unchanged even with the reductions. And I think that's going to make it really challenging. But again, we can only worry about FY 19 and 20 budgets so much tonight. I think a lot of this has to be about this. I would like to see that $8,900 reduced because I don't like seeing that. And there's a number of other budgets where I have seen it, and we'll look to make similar changes there. I mean, honestly, the school resource officer is the same thing. Has been doing the job for the past year and the budget that they have, and now expanding the budget. Mm-hmm. So we're going to see this over and over again. And so there's no right answer to this. All I'm trying to do is be consistent. And so, but outside of that, I think the grammar school did what they could to try to keep this reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, the resultant budget is something that I could support.
Well, we did say 2.5%, so.
We did. That's what we're trying to get to. Yes, and, you know, as we see more numbers, and I think our picture, you know, a month ago, we also had $500,000 set aside in the preliminary budget for free cash.
Right.
The 2.5%, you know, they did an excellent job as far as keeping it roughly at the 2.5%. My only concern, I think, which you mentioned before, is, you know, we're having some reductions here in the system, but it's not being reflected in the budget. And yet the budget continues to grow, even though we're having some reductions. And I realize there's different state mandates and so on and so forth, but, you know, it's almost like you have to go through with a fine-tooth comb. You know, you brought up the $8,900 there, and it doesn't sound like a lot, but when you look at the budget and you put the school systems together and the overall town budget, that's a big chunk of the town budget. So every little bit, wherever it may come from, is a help.
It might be nice at some point to ask the school to show us a theoretical 5-year staffing plan. Because if they're dropping a grade, I'd like to have them show me that they're freezing hiring for full-time teachers as they drop a grade, if, and maybe dropping it, you know, their staffing. I'm just afraid they're going to try to hold on any way they can. And
well, I don't want to make it too much into the school holding on to stuff, because right. I think that they did a very commendable job in
on the overall
in amending their budget and presenting their budget, and I really do appreciate that. And you know, my the thing that I would look to move is not to get it down to 2.something% or the dollar amount to whatever that dollar amount works out to. Is I really do not like, you know, and again, it's in a lot of these budgets. I really don't like that mindset of spending the money for something, adding it to your next year's budget and saying you're already doing it, yeah, and then not reducing wherever the funding came from before. And so that's why that caught my eye very specifically initially and still. But otherwise, I do think that, you know, I do want to support what they're doing, and I don't want to try to micromanage their line items, because I think that's their job and they've done a good job of it. They're faced with a lot of challenges, and you know, the town and the schools are both in the same boat in that regard.
It's a very, very difficult thing, because like you say, we definitely know, they know the school population is shrinking, and yet there's a mass to certain things sometimes where there's a certain amount of cost until it gets to a certain point. I liken it to taking an aircraft carrier from New York to London, and it's going to cost about so much to take that aircraft carrier, whether there's one sailor more or less, you know, a little less food, a little less weight on the ship, but it's so insignificant, you can't do much about it. But if all of a sudden you have half the aircraft and you get a smaller aircraft carrier, then it shrinks, and that's kind of a rough description. But so I agree. I'm not in a position to know exactly what that is, but certainly people out in the public are cognizant of the shrinkage of the population, and of course they're thinking smaller money, and we have to trust them to know what they're doing.
Does anyone have any other line items or other opinions to share other than kind of the thematic stuff we've talked about or the specific things we've talked about?
No.
Okay. Well, I'd make a motion then to recommend a budget of $4,463,323, which is the requested budget minus $8,900. And, you know,
what was the number?
It's 4,460,323. And, you know, often I won't make the motions, but since this is something that I kind of voiced and believed in, I will go ahead and make it.
I'll second it.
Okay. It's made and seconded. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any is that? 1, 2, 3. Bill?
Bill
is that an aye?
Oh, aye. Yeah.
Aye.
One abstention.
One abstention. So it passes 5-0-1. Okay. Frontier Regional Budget. Budget number 3125400. I'm going to start by saying that this budget increase we know is fairly large. I think this is one that we may want to discuss tomorrow with the select board, because this isn't like a one line item issue or a $8,000 issue. This is what are we going to do? How are we going to proceed with this? This is a significant investment of the town's resources year over year. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, again, it's not about a line item and it's not about a service of having it or not. It's about, you know, what can we do with this? Does anyone have any more discussion you'd like to have tonight, or do you agree that makes sense to discuss it at the joint meeting as a large increase within the budget?
I agree. I'd like to hold it till tomorrow night.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, we'll hold transportation while I'm sure that will be less contentious, just so that we have them together. I would like to do Franklin Tech assessment. So this requested amount I have is 238156. The budget number is 320-5410. The budget is lower this year from last. It is up on a per student basis. There are fewer students attending, so that's the reason for the reduction. And I'd say that I thought that the Franklin Tech budget was very well articulated, you know, their handout, and I mm-hmm. exchanged a couple emails with people over there. I thought they were helpful as well. So like the other school administrators we've dealt with, I want to commend them on that. Does anyone have any questions or comments or opinions on this number here?
Nope.
My only comment is that they always do a great job on the budget.
Exactly.
And usually if it goes up, it's because we have additional students.
Yeah.
And this will be the first time since the building opened, I think they'll be bonding structural improvements, you know, after this budget.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's a good point to raise. So just clarification for anyone watching, there are going to be some capital projects, roof, windows,
blacktop
mm-hmm. that will be done at the tech school or in the process of being planned and done. And those will affect future budgets that will bond for those. And so those will be increased costs passed back to town assessments through the annual costs of the bond that they have to take out, but those do not appear in this budget here.
How many students do we have there?
Oh.
10
14.
We went from 16 wow. to 14, I believe, mm-hmm. year over year.
It's gone down, which surprised me. The requirement to get into it, they have a waiting list to get into it.
Yeah, I believe it.
Yeah. I have to echo John's comments about their budget. They do a fantastic job with it. And they have an excellent program.
Okay. Would anyone like to make a motion then?
I make a motion.
Seconded.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous? Okay. Next one is highway expense budget. I'm sorry. Well, budget number is 422.50, 420, but I have a handout for you. So. Okay. You can open up your old one to see the changes. But this is the one that will be has been submitted.
Yeah. Wait a second.
Okay, so just to recap, so the previous budget had been request. The previous budget request was 260,900. So now we're at 245,400. So now one change to note, and actually I'll pass this out now because we'll talk about it next. Is that there was one set of expenses that Kevin has found could be moved onto winter snow and ice removal. So I'm passing that out. Now we'll be discussing that next. That budget request was revised up by 2,000. That is plow related hardware that had been part of the general highway expense
right.
budget.
Yeah.
I think we actually talked about this when he was in here. Yep. He found can be put, those specific things can be put into winter snow and ice removal. So that's a small part of the reduction on the general highway expense.
Is the 8,000?
Everybody get one of those? The winter snow and ice?
Hmm?
Yep.
Yep, I just passed them out. Yep. So I think we went through a lot of these line items kind of in detail. And so the way I would kind of boil down our decisions or thoughts on this is right now Kevin has requested a budget of 245,400. That is a larger increase in some of the budgets that we're seeing. And I think that almost the entirety of that increase comes from the tree work line item, which last year to this year is up by 14,000. So out of the 18,000 increase, 14 is tree work. Mm-hmm. And so in the interest of not trying to overly manage the line items, to the extent that people would like to reduce, I think we just talk about what the size of the tree work budget line item should be, because Kevin's not here to talk about taking 500 out of this one or 700 out of that one. I think the real question is, how much do we want to increase tree work from 22,000 last year?
Maybe go back to the 26.
I got to tell you that last year nothing got done in town. I don't think the few trees they took down, at least one of them was the wrong tree. So I could see they needed to put more resources into that.
I need to speak up for Kevin, who is, I'm the Lorax, I speak for the trees. Kevin did do a significant amount of tree work last year. Most of it was as a result of the storms, various snowstorms, various windstorms, and that sort of thing that happened. There were a number of trees that were taken down on, I want to say it's Crestview, the roads up here along the ridge. Is that, do I have the right?
No. Crestview is a left off of
Hillcrest.
I'm sorry, Hillcrest.
Hillcrest.
Along there, there were a number of trees that came down, a number of branches that came down. There were some trees up on the old Main Street and old Deerfield that were taken down. And there was some additional tree work that happened just generally down in the South Deerfield area. Yes, there was some tree work that has not that hasn't been done, and yet at the same time, this budget, the $22,000, that's still being expended right now. He will likely be looking at additional tree work that will be done this spring before the end of the fiscal year, because there's only a certain window where you can do that safely, and so on and so forth. Remember that anytime there's a tree that, and I know Kevin's already said this, but anytime there's electrical wires involved, he has to hire out.
Right, like over by the cemetery here.
Yes, exactly. In that case, it's not just a bucket truck, but in that case, it'll also be a crane.
They craned it out, yeah. Right. So, to echo what I believe, Kevin has said before in our meetings as well, is, when we don't stay on top of this, or even sometimes when you do, you get these situations that get very expensive because of wires or structures or what have you. That he can go through that money pretty quickly. And so I do think that number needs to go up. And I think Kevin has done a very good job of getting not just his overall budgets transparent and lined up, but his line items. He's probably moved more line items, added or moved in a way that, I'm not using this for this, I'm deleting it, or I'm spending this money on this thing, it needs to go in. And, I think that's...
That needed to be done.
Yeah, and, hopefully he's kind of gotten it to a good place where now it'll be more stable year over year and make it even easier to kind of track, but... I do support increasing this line item. I think it's just a question of how much.
I think with the trees, it's a very dangerous situation too. It's kind of out of sight, out of mind. But if one comes down and somebody gets killed, that's terrible. And didn't he say that the big picture, his wild guesstimate was like $90,000 to really get on top of it? So he's kind of picking away at it, but there's a lot more yet to be done.
Unfortunately, Mother Nature hasn't helped him any because they've taken down so many trees.
I agree. But
the electric company and the phone company, they're taking trees down all over the place, and just to try to save the electricity and whatever.
Wires and that. Yeah.
And it's like $1,000 a tree. These big ones.
Oh,
be expensive.
Or more.
Far beyond that too. Yeah. But I guess I'm just saying it's critical work, that's all.
Okay, so let's try something different. Let's take a poll of number and thousands for tree work budget, and I'll start with seniority down to my left here. If anyone wants to say, not as a motion, but just what do you think that number should be for tree work, or pass if someone doesn't want to.
You mean an increase from 22 to 36,000?
Yeah, well, instead of, so it was 22, it's requested 36. What number for tree work do you think makes sense? I'm just going to go down the line.
If he has to go up and spend an extra $100,000 on tree work, my proposition would be that he would do this over 6 to 8 years minimum. So you're talking probably 10 grand per year, and then we can adjust it later. So if you got 22, you go to 32.
Okay.
That's where I think.
All right. Bill?
How do I say this? We're certainly all overpaying on our electric bills to have those orange trucks idled for many hours every day hiding. But it'd be interesting to see, they really are trimming the heck out of everything. So maybe we drop this back a bit for a year to 32.
All right, so you're also at 32. Okay, Mary?
I agree we should cut it back a little bit and bring it up gradually, just because the budget is so far over what it's been.
Okay.
And I'll go with the 32.
That is so good.
I'll say 30 just to say something else. Jeff?
I think the 32 makes sense.
Okay. Ralph?
I believe in hiring managers who have a lot more in-depth knowledge about the situation. I stick with his number.
36. Okay. All right. Do we want to discuss any other line items to this budget or overall number, or would somebody like to make a motion for a number?
Well, if we put the 245,400 on the warrant to run the omnibus budget, somebody's going to hold it, and I believe that Kevin's going to have to defend it. So, I mean, if we decide that we want it less than that, I don't know if the selectmen will.
Well, this is clearly going to be discussed, and I think Kevin's going to make a very strong case, because I think there is a lot of work to be done. It's something that has been ignored in previous years, both from a budget standpoint and also just the amount of man hours needing to be spent on other things. He's run a pretty good ship on that front. So I don't feel one way or the other about, let's say we use 32. So 32 would be 241,400. I think either way, it's going to be a conversation. So I think we should be doing kind of what we feel we'd recommend, and understanding that Kevin may go up and give a very persuasive argument, and the town can vote its pleasure.
I'll make a motion that we approve 241,400.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Seconded.
That's all right.
Wait a second. 241,400.
Right. So that is reducing.
That's reducing at 4,000.
Yeah. And to be honest, and I think make an important point, because this is how I feel, if Kevin, with a 241,400, would rather take that out of some other line and leave it in Truework,
that's fine.
We're talking about it because that's easier, that's the big increase, right. But, you know, I still support him if he comes back and said, all right, 241, if the town votes that, I'm still doing 36 and I'll take it out of somewhere else, you know, that's for him to do. So 241,400, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? All right, so it passes 5-1.
We can come back in next year, address this to make sure it doesn't drop down.
Look, it's a good increase, and I think all this stuff needs to be done in an iterative fashion. You know, trying to jump, it's like, you know, a lot of these gas line items are lower, but not as much lower as gasoline is, because if you jump all the way, you're going to be jumping every year, and all the budgets are going to be all over the place.
This one will be interesting to see, because they are trimming everything.
They who?
The power company.
Oh, power companies, okay. Right.
They're going back through five times on the same roads.
Right, but then Mother Nature takes them down, and they work on overnight cutting them up.
Okay. The next one is the Senior Center expense budget. That is budget number 541-5420. This budget was presented quite a few weeks ago, actually. And the budget is lower than last year. And the thing that we talked about then, and I just want to point out now, is the manner in which this is lower year over year is from eliminating the employee benefits line item. You see the fourth from the top, which had been 12,000 and now is zero. Now, it is the case that the person eligible for that benefit is not taking that benefit. But as I think we've talked about, I find a little bit precarious to start putting that in the budget, because then, you know, if I was another department head with five people reporting to me and some of them weren't taking it, or I wasn't taking it, or whatever, you know, that's a slippery road to go down a little bit. But if that, in this, I kind of look a little bit to Doug here, you know, if we feel comfortable and confident with this approach for this particular situation, it's something that I would support. How do you, not to put you on the spot to confirm it or affirm it, how do you feel about it?
Mixed feelings.
Okay.
The person that's in that position has chosen to not take benefits. Not to take advantage of health insurance.
Right.
Let's be clear about that. They can change their mind tomorrow.
That's right.
Go and sign up for health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
When in reviewing this budget, however, that person stated pretty clearly that they probably would not be taking advantage of the town's health insurance plan and was okay with submitting a budget that did not include an appropriation for health insurance, a request for health insurance costs. That person could change their mind in 1 July. There's an open enrollment for a certain period of time, what have you. That person could take another job, and then the next person coming in could choose to take health insurance benefits, in which case this budget would have to be revoted and an appropriation added. So for those reasons, I would say it makes more sense to keep the insurance line item in there, at least as a placeholder, 8,500, 9,000, 9,500, something like that, to basically say this is an appropriation for health insurance. That being said, from the budgetary point of view, I feel really uncomfortable requesting an appropriation of $8,000, $9,000 that I know won't be spent.
Right.
When we're looking at, you know, arguments and discussions over $3,000 and $4,000 reductions in one budget or another.
Right.
So that side of me wins out. I would rather leave the appropriation for health insurance off, with the understanding that that could change at any moment. It is throwing the dice a little bit. Mm-hmm. But I would rather do that and hold back the $9,000 or $8,000 for use elsewhere in the overall budget.
Right. And I think that's kind of exactly where I fall out, actually.
What's a SIG expenditure?
The SIG grant, and I couldn't tell you exactly what SIG refers to. It's a grant, actually, that the senior center has been able to take advantage of for the past couple of years. The SIG expenditures refers to expenses related to that grant. The grant basically has to do, it was applied for and received to help support the outreach activities of the senior center. It pays for the outreach coordinator's salary as well as expenses related to outreach.
Right. So the SIG grant at the bottom of 13840, that is equal to the 10920 salary plus the 2920 expenses.
That's correct.
So that is offset.
Correct.
The outreach coordinator, they don't have one, do they?
We are in the process of trying to hire one.
Oh, okay.
There was one there for a short while. She discontinued the position. The outreach efforts are being done by the director in the short term, but the Board of Oversight has requested that somebody be hired to fulfill that position. It's going to be a tough fill, unfortunately.
How many people on that Board of Oversight, Doug?
Three?
Yeah.
One from each town. One selectman from each town.
So we don't have 50% of the votes?
No.
Really? You really want to go there?
You want to open that up?
I'm sorry. We're just getting to that budget. I just thought it'd warm us up, right? Okay.
We actually do here.
Would anybody like to make a motion for the requested amount of 24108 or make a comment if you'd like to change it?
I make a motion for the 24108 for the senior center expenses.
Seconded.
Okay, made and seconded. And just to confirm, this is the Deerfield portion of their budget of 24108. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Nope. Okay. Next budget is the Tilton Library, 610-5400.
Did we get a new one on that?
We did. It should be in here. The one that's in your packet should be the new budget. The total I see, Doug, I think this is right, 161049?
161049, correct. Right. That represents 2.5%.
What a coincidence.
Precisely.
What is the total?
161049. And, you know, I think we talked through this budget when, it's 610-5400 is the account number. We talked through, I think the only thing that kind of, not changed, but came to light for me was when we were talking about the budget initially in our first meeting, there wasn't much mention of the various capital projects that came up. And I didn't know how the committee here felt. Like, let's say you had two different departmental budgets, one with a number of capital requests and one without. Would you be more inclined to vote a bigger increased budget for the one that didn't have capital requests versus did, or do you think those are totally separate? Especially, I know like the photocopier is one that's kind of right in between capital or not capital.
Yeah.
Should that be in this budget or not? So that's the only thing that kind of came to mind for me on this one. I'll open it up to the floor. Jeff, you look like you've...
There was a point in the past where the Capitol Committee would do their work with a timeline of handing it, the information, to the Finance Committee, mm-hmm. so they could kind of incorporate that in their thinking, right. And it didn't happen this year.
Well, if you know someone on the Capitol Committee...
No. Well, it's a moving target.
No, I agree, and that's where I think... Look, our timelines this year, I think on almost all the committees and boards, good. Are better.
Yeah.
You know, we were having... I don't even think we had the... You know, last year we went right into the town meeting. But I agree, that would have helped. And, you know, that's not all on the heels or on the... That's not all on the fault of the library. It's, you know, all the process that we all right. need to get, you know,
when
quicker.
There's pushback, it right. kind of stalls things out.
So would anybody like to recommend this budget, or would somebody...
I still have a little bit of a concern with the additional hours in that, with the $5,000 increase there. And I realize they did hit the 2.5, but I think they're talking about an additional 4 hours, if I remember correctly.
I think so, yeah.
Per week in that. I'm still struggling with that a little bit, where I kind of understand it to an extent, but at the same time, there's programs being offered there where I think that they could hold... You know, part of the reason for additional hours is quiet time and so on and so forth. But I'm wondering if some of those evening meetings could be held here in the town hall. Or why do they have to, all those different programs have to be held at the library, I guess? Are they trying to make it a community center? Is that the idea of it? Or, you know, I guess I'm struggling with that a little bit, because we have buildings, I think, that would be available. And... you know, this might fit into one of those senior things also, as far as providing additional coverage without the pay for a tax break.
Does this budget now include the extra hours?
Yeah, well...
Because it was at 171.
It lists additional hours payroll at 5,824, so it appears that it's still contemplating, maybe not the same because we can't see the detail here, but mm-hmm. right. at least some additional hours. And I share Jeff's concerns. We've seen there's requests for additional either staff or hours from, I think, at least 7 different departments. Right. And, you know, given the budget, you know, that's where you look at that on the one hand, and then the budget numbers we talked about in the beginning, and it's like it's 2 different towns,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm. Well, her original request was 171,828.
Right. Well, I think that I'll make this assumption, we all agree that the minimum we're funding is to make sure that their state budget minimums are met. So, like, nobody's mm-hmm. contemplating going below, you know, 157,439. It looks like this number is.
Right.
I think that the two moving parts are the additional hours and, you know, for me, to some extent, the photocopier specifically is a capital item, or should it be in this budget? I understand that you can argue it's more than 5-year lifespan, so by the...
Unfortunately, we're sending conflicting messages.
Right.
It's not the department's fault. It's us. Not the finance committee, but... Anyway, there's conflicting messages going out, and John tried to work to his charter, mm-hmm. and Carolyn and I'm part of the problem. We were pushing because Carolyn didn't feel she had the visibility on some of these items and was using that mechanism to go through those.
Well, the visibility I support, because having a holistic picture of a department's capital items, both big picture funded outside of their budget and right. smaller funded inside, is important. So I'm with that. The problem is, should some of those smaller items still be funded through the budget? Because mm. that's where it really matters, right? You know, now that being funded out of the municipal building reserve fund or free cash or whatever, instead of being part of this budget, that's where it makes a difference. Even if we support that purchase.
Well, it makes the 2.5% increase, or the 1.025%, it has to go. So her minimum right now is 157,439.
Mm-hmm.
But the budget actually has $2,000 more in it with the capital.
Do they count that?
Well, I would think so. That's the, my question I is. Think I don't a, think they do. I
no,
think they,
it's,
this is, it's separate.
Yeah, I think it's separate.
The actually, just to clarify, the mandated increase in order to maintain state funding for the library is 2.5% of the previous 3 years' average.
Yeah.
Right. So you actually have to take. Let me see if I can do the math.
Well,
really
she got,
well
she's got 157,439.
But that's not that won't come out.
That won't come out to that though.
No,
sure.
No,
well,
like
while he's calculating that, and I don't mean to get into the details of this copier, but the town here went to leasing a copier. I don't know, you know, would it make sense since their town due to put that all under a lease? As opposed to
it's kind of a quirky copier. It's a two-sided, multicolor, but they charge 20 cents a page for the use of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's not necessarily paying its own way, but it's paying for supplies and ink for the library.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But even if it was leased, they could still charge.
Right. Yeah, I don't know.
I'm just thinking
cheap
from
price, and that old one looked.
Yeah.
To be honest, Ralph, actually, to buy the copier for $2,100 and to be able to use it for 3 to 5 years, that's getting away cheap.
Right.
Yeah.
Our leases on these machines are.
That would be the next logical question, but I just was asking the question.
I appreciate that. Yeah, but granted, these are much larger machines, but our leases are about $300 to $400 a month, mm-hmm. and there's fees every quarter for usage,
mm-hmm.
And that's actually the penalty of a lease is you're paying by page. So it gets expensive very quickly.
Yeah. Well, like I say, that would be the next logical question, but I just was thinking about that when you're talking about capital and purchasing it.
Doug, would it be possible, at this point in the process where we are, if different parties did want to support it, could you take, let's say, the copier and put it back as part of the budget appropriation? Or basically take it out of capital, and obviously, you know, I'm not saying I want to do it. I'm saying functionally, could you do it?
You
because should this be something we talk about tomorrow with the select board about capital items and which ones, even if there's oversight, should they stay out of the budgets or in the budgets? Would that be something that'd be worth?
Let me ask you this. Will she be buying a new copier every year for the library?
No.
Then I would leave it out of the operating budget. I think that was the decision last year. Was it last year when the finance committee actually chose to include the police cruiser as a budget item in the omnibus budget because it was a regular predictable expense.
Okay.
That didn't get reviewed by CIPC, I don't believe. I could be wrong.
No,
Bill,
you're right.
Please correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay.
But that's now considered an operational expense and not a capital expense, even though technically it is a capital expense.
Well, it's its own capital budget, but doesn't go through the capital process, right?
And so for exactly the opposite reasoning, I would actually suggest leaving the copier as a single appropriation in the capital budget.
Okay.
Even though technically it doesn't qualify.
Okay.
But it's otherwise you're increasing this budget artificially and you'd actually want to decrease it next year. Because you wouldn't be buying a copy
next year.
Might go on
for 3-4 years. Right,
exactly. So does that make sense?
I can kind of get behind that. Does anyone else feel?
Makes sense.
Okay. All right. So then I guess we're back to, you know, on this, there's the issue of the additional hours. But again, you know, we're voting the budget. We're not voting how they spend the money on the budget.
Right.
And we, at least I, would not be comfortable reducing this budget by 58.24 because that would take them through the minimum.
Right.
So I don't really think that's an option. We could reduce the budget by some amount due to the fact that there's still additional hours in here. But that's, I mean, I guess we're really either passing the budget as it stands or let's say, and I'm just going to make up a number, passing a budget of $159,000, and I'm just picking something kind of halfway between, you know, 157 and 161. How do people feel?
They hit the 2.5.
What's the percentage increase?
The doing the math on the formula, the 3-year average of the previous three fiscal years is 153,598, mm-hmm. and the 2.5% increase on top of that would be 157,438.
Oh.
So the 161 certainly exceeds that.
Right.
That limit.
Right. And I don't want to get near that limit or get cute with that limit because we do support the library and I do support your efforts. I don't support the additional hours, because I'm not supporting additional staffing and hours in any of the budgets that we've seen so far, and I don't think I will the rest of the way either, just because of the situation we're in, not because I wouldn't like to do it if I could.
Didn't we vote this before with 160, 250?
I don't believe we voted this. I believe it was presented at 171.
And yeah, presented at 171. And we found out the minimum required was 157,438.
Right. We held off on voting it.
And we put it on hold, but for some reason I highlighted the 160, 250, and I don't know why.
I think I had suggested that we contemplate voting that amount, but it became clear in that conversation that it seemed like the best course was to let them go back and resubmit the budget and see where they come in.
Right.
And so here's where they are. So actually, that's a fair point. Then I guess maybe that amount would be the right amount to vote if we don't support this, since that is what we suggest. Although that was a while ago and we didn't have the budget picture, so I don't really think that's relevant, actually.
But
I think
you're right. Yeah. She was going to go back.
Right, and she did. Yeah. And this is where is where we are.
Did we get another sheet from her?
This is it.
This is it.
Oh, sorry.
I don't have it either.
So. Okay, I took this off my printer.
He needs the detail.
And I got it from my wife because she's one of the commissioners.
Oh, what has she got there for a number?
161049.
Yeah, that's it.
So I'd be content with anybody who wanted to make an argument somewhere between, 159 or the recommended amount, depending on if people feel that funding this, and they did get to 2.5%, and we did talk about that number. That said, the budget, I think, is in a tougher spot now than it was a month ago, and we're having other budgets that we're pushing some below 2.5% and looking for money where we can. And that's where, we'd have to answer the question, if asked by the town at town meeting, of why are you supporting extra staffing in one place and cutting things that we know we need in other places?
Right. And I'm struggling with this because of, with Brenda's situation, as far as that dollar amount, the town accountant, and hopefully we do go back and revisit that next year. As a finance committee, I think it's very important that we address that again next year. I'm struggling with this as far as the additional hours, and I'd like to be as consistent as possible with the rhyme and reason of why we're doing this. John, that dollar amount you had before that we voted on was 160,250.
160,250.
But we didn't vote it.
We didn't vote it.
Well, we had talked about
that. At that point in time, which I think was like a 2% increase. I think that's how we got to that number, but I don't have that, let's say.
I think that's probably what it was, a 2%er.
Yeah, that's within spitting distance of 2%.
Yeah.
All right, well then, would anybody like to make a motion of either 159, 160,250, or 161,049?
159.5.
Oh no, you're getting awfully close to. I make a motion.
Touché. Hang on. No, Ralph.
I make a motion for
160. Ralph's already got a motion.
Ralph's made a motion for 159.
Oh, I'm sorry.
500.
I thought it was a joke. Standing too close to our minimum.
Yeah. Would anyone like to second that?
I want to hear his.
Okay. All right. Then. Would you like to, what do you want to do
it
next?
It dies from a lack of second.
I will withdraw.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Bill, what would you like to say?
They came back with a 2.5% budget. I'm just nervous. We're so close to that state minimum that I don't want us to flag. But I think this is a department like seniors where, we're overstepping their guidance committees or prudential committees, but it would be nice to, when we start pressing on hours, how much we're using the facility and when, I think a profile of that would be good to see before any increases in either of the departments. And
all right,
so I don't know what to say.
All right, well then
I'd recommend 160,250.
That's what I was going to do.
Okay.
160,250. Would anyone like to second that?
I'll second that.
Thank you.
That's $799 less than the requested amount.
That won't kill anyone.
Right. And just for purposes of clarification, I guess there is some consistency to the fact that that was the number we talked about initially.
Right.
And yes. All those in favor of 160-250?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, unanimous. Okay. I have two more budgets for us to handle, and then lots of other stuff, so everybody, nobody get tired on me. The next two budgets I want to talk about are the Summer Swim Program and the Tri-Town Beach. The numbers are 630-5400 and 630-5410, and I'm hoping that Doug can give us a little perspective on where we stand with this. I think, I mean, I guess I will say I've had difficulty in getting answers of who the people to contact are or what these budgets are or have been or anything.
The current representatives, I'm losing my mind. I'm trying to remember her name. I have been working with a woman named Sue Foley, who was appointed to the Tri-Town Beach Committee, I think last spring, but more recently got more active and involved, called a meeting. And the meeting consisted of Sue Foley, Beth Foley, I apologize, Beth Foley. I can't think of the name of our other representative, but she was present. And then two representatives from Whately, Sue Monahan and Bill Skrosky. Boy, I'm tough with names. They met last week. They reviewed the budget, which you have in the book, and they approved that budget for their FY17 request for the coming
fiscal year. This is Tri-Town Beach you're talking about.
Tri-Town Beach. Okay. There was no action taken on the Tri-Town Swim Program because there was some question as to exactly how it worked, and what encompassed it. Beth is going to be doing some more research on that. The Swim Program is a program of Deerfield only. The Tri-Town Beach is an appropriation made by Deerfield to the Tri-Town Beach
program that's set up, funded by the town of Deerfield, and any kid that wants to come in there can come in there, and they charge different fees. If you're a local kid, then you go in there for free. Mm-hmm. And if you're from Sunderland or Whately, then you go in there for a charge, which goes towards the town of Deerfield for that training.
Whately pays a share of Tri-Town Beach.
Tri-Town Beach, but not the swim program.
Not the swim program.
Right.
So
there were a number of questions that Beth Foley and I both had in regard to the Tri-Town Beach program. Questions about how many people used it, how many passes were sold, who purchased them, where they were from, how cash handling was done, who was going to be hired. Something which made me cock my ear just a little bit, and I've asked Sue Monahan for a response on this, is the fact that summer staff help hired gets 2 weeks of vacation time.
No.
And I asked the question, please tell me you mean that they just can allocate 2 weeks worth of time off throughout the summer, and that was forgivable, but that it's not paid, and I'm waiting for confirmation on that. I asked if there would be a purchase of a cash register in their budget for the coming year, because up to this point it's been done through, my understanding is through a box, a cigar box, something along those lines. I asked if there would be cash handling procedures put into place to ensure verification of amounts being checked in and verification of deposits. I did get a complete printout of the FY15 expenses through the Tri-Town Beach account, which is of course separate because it's the district.
We manage that account here though?
What's that?
Is that account controlled in here?
Understanding is that there's actually a total of three separate accounts. There's one for Tri-Town Beach that's managed by the town of Whately. There's one for Summer Swim Program that's handled through the town of Deerfield. And then there is a third separate account, which is part of the Tri-Town Beach district. Which is a third account completely separate. That's the one that I do have accounting for.
That's where the money goes in for what the receipts are. They go into that separate account.
And the accounting I have shows receipts being taken in. It shows expenses going out. But the expenses going out are detailed. water testing, supplies purchase, whatever it happens to be. But none of those purchases are actually in the budget for Tri-Town Beach. And, you know, just, you know, looking back at the Tilton Library, that's actually something that, that Sarah worked diligently to do this year for you, was to include the grant money that she received and the state aid that she received, and also to include the expenditures that those things paid for. The South County Senior Center does the same thing. The SIG grant comes in, and the money goes out for certain things. I would like to see that in the Tri-Town Beach budget so we get a better sense as to where it's coming from. But I would actually recommend that you take no action on this budget right now, and allow Sue Monahan and the folks to, I hope I'm pronouncing her name right, allow them the opportunity to respond to the questions and possibly to come back with a more solid budget proposal. I know we're cutting close to the wire, but I think that's fair.
The hiring of these college kids,
yep.
Who's paying them?
It is the Tri-Town Beach Commission.
So they're on the hook for liability insurance and such?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. And there is an appropriation, I believe, in that budget for insurance.
There is.
Okay.
And Doug, is there, and maybe someone else has this as well. First of all, I agree with what you're saying. I think that these are tough budgets to kind of get your hand around, not because I don't like these services, but just there's kind of been a lack of communication and clarity on them. But I also agree with giving some time for people to provide that clarity. Could the summer swim program be run through the rec department?
I had a conversation today with Sue Antonellis about that, and actually she said no, absolutely not. No, it doesn't want anything to do with it. It wasn't anything against the summer swim program or the Tri-Town Beach or anything like that, but she already has a full slate of activities that she's very heavily involved with. We did get into a good conversation about other options for kids who want to do swimming lessons and that sort of thing, but without getting boots on the ground and talking to a number of different individuals, I wouldn't repeat any of the things that we mentioned here.
That's fair.
Yeah.
I guess I meant more her just kind of spearheading, directing the traffic, still utilizing, the Tri-Town Beach resources that have been running this program. I don't think it's starting over, but again, that's a longer conversation that probably won't be resolved in this budget season.
Sure, right.
So
I know that the summer program and different things like that include part of the swim program. Is the kids that go to the summer program go to Tri-Town Beach. Right. So that's why part of this is included for the town.
That could be. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. I know that the River Valley Day Camp uses the beach.
Right, but they pay us.
And that's separate from rec. That's not associated with the rec department.
No.
And yes, they do pay a fee to the Tri-Town Beach for use of the beach for the summer. Yeah.
Years ago, I was there a few times with the grandkids, and it looked like they ran a real good swim program. And they kept an eye on the kids, and they looked like real qualified instructors, and I was impressed with
very intense training.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I agree with Doug to pass on these two. We can look to pick these up potentially next week. I actually take back, there was one more omnibus budget that we needed to revisit, which is the winter snow and ice removal.
Yes.
That is number 423-5400. We discussed this before. We had passed 83,000. It has been increased to 85,000 for the reasons I described. Unless there's any other conversation, I'd entertain a motion for the 85,000.
So moved.
Thank you. Any seconds?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Which one are we just voting?
That is winter snow and ice removal budget number 423-5400, passed unanimously in the amount of $85,000.
So may I run down the list very, very quickly to make sure I'm not missing anything?
Sure.
I'm only going to mention the items that you have not voted, at least according to my record, and I may be wrong, so please correct me.
Yep.
Selectman staff salaries, you have not voted.
Right.
Police payroll, you have not voted.
Right.
Frontier Regional.
Right.
Frontier Transportation.
Right.
Summer Swim Program, Tri-Town Beach.
Yep.
And then separate warrant articles.
Right, which we're gonna move on to next.
What are we moving on to?
Warrant articles. See how much more there is on that list?
Yes, I see that.
That's all tonight, or as much as we can get through. I would like to start with a couple of items. I'd like to do these a little out of order because there's a couple that I know we're going to be talking about tomorrow. Perfect. I guess I'll pass these out.
Oh, good.
Are these copies for everyone? What do we got here?
While you're passing those out, I'll take this reminder to remind our viewers at home. Special town meeting, 7 o'clock, April 25th. The warrant will be published in the newspaper on Friday.
Special town meeting? You mean regular town meeting?
Special town meeting will be held concurrently. So a special town meeting will be first. It's very short. It's about 8 articles. The regular town meeting happens immediately following. Coming up on Monday, April 25th.
Do we have a copy of the special?
Yep. Special and annual are both there.
The special is a single page.
The annual is stapled. The special town meeting warrant will be published in the Greenfield Recorder.
Oh, I'm sorry. I see what he did. I was confused.
We're all looking for a single page.
Yeah. Here's the special.
Here's the single.
Trouble when you're dealing with an old committee. Old committee members.
Okay. I want to take a second to just scroll through these special town meeting articles to see what we may want to do tonight versus next week.
Do you anticipate any shortfall for snow and ice?
I checked with Kevin today. I asked him about the winter work that he did just yesterday and today.
Before it snowed?
He says he's fairly close to his budget, but not over yet. So if we're very, very lucky, we may be able to just pass over that article, taking no action.
Doug, are there articles in the special warrant that you would recommend us take up or at least discuss tonight in preparation for tomorrow's meeting?
Let me quickly check that.
As I go through this, I mean, the energy loan we'll be talking about anyway.
Yep, the energy loan you're going to be talking about. Article 1 is snow and ice removal. Article 2 is the South County EMS administrative transfer. That's money into our bank. I don't see why you would not approve that. Article 3... that's the energy loan. Article four is appropriating money from the municipal building fund. That's portion of the CIPC recommendations. Right. We're doing that now in the special so we can immediately move that money so we can immediately get to work on those items. Otherwise, we would have to wait till July 1.
Okay.
So that's why it's on the special.
All right.
Article 5 clarifies, and this is something you may want to consider. It's ugly the way it's printed, but what it does is clarify who is eligible for shift differential pay by reversing the responsibility for determining that to the department instead of the individual. What this change in language is designed to do is to make the department determine whether or not they pay shift differential instead of judging it on an individual basis.
Okay.
And what it's trying to do is basically say, if the department schedules people for second or third shift for more than 8 months out of the year, then they must pay the shift differential. It would not cover poll workers, for example. Even though they're here on sometimes late at night, they wouldn't get a shift differential for their time if they even get paid hourly, I'm not sure. It would not cover highway workers who work second or third shift, but only occasionally, and it's not regularly scheduled.
So the only one that's really affected is the police department.
Police and ambulance.
Yes, the police are under contract.
Correct. Yeah. The contract exactly mirrors these rates and these criteria. Yeah.
So what does this mean? You said the other was the ambulance. EMS. So what does it mean practically for them pre this language to post?
Up to this point, the ambulance service has been paying the shift differential at the older rates, which is, I think, 45 cents and 60 cents, but only to their full-time employees and not to their per diem employees. In checking with the police chief, he pays shift differential for anyone who works second or third shift, regardless of whether their employment status. And that started the conversation.
So what was the genesis of this article? Where did this come from?
This came from a conversation that started with a question submitted through someone at the police department about the ambulance service, whether or not they're paying a shift differential. The ambulance service responded and said, absolutely, we're paying a shift differential. And that started the further conversation. It went over to the town clerk's office as the HR person. And then finally over to my office, where I basically said, okay, well, let's get this straight. Because obviously interpreting the bylaw the way it existed was very, very confusing. Is someone regularly scheduled for a third shift if they are only scheduled for it once in a month? Or is a person regularly scheduled for a third shift if there is always someone regularly scheduled for that third shift?
Okay.
And so the proposal is basically to say, okay, never mind looking at the individual, look at the shift. Do you always schedule a third shift? Then it doesn't matter who's there, they get shift differential.
Would this be something the personnel board would have particular input on? Like, it doesn't really...
I would think they would definitely have input on it.
I would think it'd be more of a personnel board recommendation than a finance committee recommendation, understanding it does have budget ramifications.
Sure.
Okay. All right. Do you think we'll be able to have a conversation, we'll give more clarity tomorrow night? Is that, or is this regarding this issue, regarding how the select board feels about this, or what their position is, or...
You want to bring it up?
Okay.
Sure. We'll make sure they're aware of it.
All right. Article 6. Okay.
It's Article 6.
Article 6.
Article
5. I'm sorry. Article 6 is...
So this is to allow...
Article
this
5.
Is to allow sewer-related expenses to be... funded from other things than users, be it grants or town appropriations. Is that accurate?
Correct.
Okay.
A strict reading of this bylaw would actually prevent us from using outside sources of money to do capital improvements on the property, mm-hmm. on the sewer system, like USDA rural development grants, like MassWorks grants, like MEMA or FEMA grants. All of which we're looking at as potential sources of funding for the work that needs to be done at the wastewater treatment plant.
Okay.
But wouldn't it also include being able to...
assess the town.
Assess all the taxpayers of the town?
Yep, would.
So you're asking to change a bylaw now that basically stipulates very clearly that all sewer-related costs would be for... sewer users, correct?
Yep. Absolutely.
And that's what we're asking.
Was there language contemplated to just lift the restriction on the more specific things you mentioned, like grants and other grant funding sources?
No,
it was not.
Okay. All right, well.
I can only tell you that, and I spent about a good half of the day with Kevin and with folks from Weston and Sampson today talking about how we're going to be able to pay for the upgrades to the wastewater treatment plant that need to be done in the next year or so, and how we're going to pay for the sewer line extensions and the changes to the old Deerfield wastewater treatment plant and the possible interconnection of both sewer districts into a single consolidated district and the possible tie-in of Sunderland's sewer facilities to ours if the towns agree to go that way. And at no time did we consider asking the town for an appropriation?
I'm sorry, at no time?
At no time during the conversation was the phrase, well, we'll get a loan and have the town pay for it out of taxation.
Sure.
Was that ever brought up?
Well, and I think, again,
but it does leave that door open. And yeah. I've had that conversation with the select board, and it appears to me that the mindset is already there that everybody would be paying for whatever was done. And I think this whole discussion myself is a little premature, because what's going to be presented to the public, I don't see any definite plans yet as far as how, who, when, where this is all going to take place. Where are the sewer lines going to run? Who's going to benefit? What roads are they going to be running on? Are you going to be hooked? Are you going to be forced to hook up if it runs by your house, if you have a septic system that's working, and so on and so forth? There's a lot of unanswered questions to bring this forward that I think need to be answered before this article is voted on, to be honest with you. And I think it's very unfair to throw this out and leave it open-ended. So it leaves a couple of people of the town to do whatever they may choose to do. And I have a problem with that. Now, as far as there's some value and benefit for everybody in town, yes, there is. And I think that should be discussed ahead of time. And I really think that there's room for compromise. And I don't see why, you know what's going to happen with this article? We're going to go to the town floor, and it's going to pit the sewer users against the people with septic tanks. And that's exactly what it's going to do. And I think that's very unfair. And I don't understand why we have to go that route, to be honest with you. I don't understand why we can't work out a compromise ahead of time that makes everybody happy and that people feel comfortable with. And then moving forward would be so much easier. Okay. And that's my feeling on it. And I know different people have different feelings, but.
All right. Thank you for that, Jeff. And I think this is an important issue that I'd like to discuss tomorrow night, this article. Mm-hmm. And probably again in our meeting next week. I think it's, you know, this is where I take a bit stricter interpretation of our role as Finance Committee. I don't know that this is something that we are here to recommend or not.
It is, actually. According to the bylaws of the town of Deerfield and the adoption of the state statute regarding finance committees,
the finance committee can make
a recommendation on any article.
Right, we can make a recommendation on any article. I agree. And that's why I said, you know, I take a little bit more narrow interpretation, whereas a voter, I certainly have opinions I wish to speak to on this, but it's things like this where I feel compelled to take my finance committee hat off because I don't know that that's really the right hat to wear at that point in time, but we can discuss that again as well. And to Jeff's point, I think that, look, there's a concern here that the language as it stands currently could protect against what some perceive to be unfair things to occur. And it's debatable if they're unfair or not, and it's debatable what may or may not happen or not. And I do agree with Jeff's point that maybe we could have a larger conversation that could make people more comfortable with these options being on the table. And, you know, I don't know if that means having a more independent sewer commission. I don't know what steps we could take to try to allay people's concerns. You know, some steps that Kevin said he was looking to take were, for instance, charging the different town buildings and departments for sewer use. That's one step we can take to more equitably distribute the costs of usage of the system. So I agree with Jeff. I think this is a larger conversation, one I think we should keep having. It'd be my desire to move on from this, have a quick overview of the next two articles, mm-hmm. but then get back to the regular town meeting warrant, that we do have a number of things I'd like to vote on tonight.
Article 7 is a zoning change that's been proposed by the Planning Board. It will allow self-storage warehousing in the C1, C2, and industrial zones by special permit.
Okay.
It's pretty straightforward. There was a previous article that was in a previous revision, which has been stricken. And the last article you should have should be Article 8. And this is to allow commercial development in the industrial park. This is the last step in the process of DDIC's process to change their operating rules, to allow them to court and invite commercial development in the industrial park.
Why are these in special town meeting?
Some of it was organized due to the financial nature of them, that they're dealing with things that relate to FY16, the current fiscal year,
right.
The snow and ice, the expenditures of monies for the municipal fund, the paying out of the $57,000 in administrative costs for the EMS. Other things are items that actually the town moderator wanted to have in this
special.
This Article 8, let me give you a different insight into that.
There you go.
I don't understand.
Being on DDIC, the purpose of this article is only to, you have to get a town meeting vote to authorize a selectman to tell our legislators to file for this exemption they're looking for, special legislation to extend its powers. We've already voted that as a town. Yeah. All we're doing is asking for the town's permission to let the selectmen petition the general court. That's all it's for.
Yep.
That's
so we've already got all the changes we want in the thing. And the idea of this is to petition the general court. And we don't even know if it's required or not. Because we get conflicting viewpoints from different people in the same offices in Boston. So we may just pass over that. We're not sure yet.
Right. Yeah.
There you go.
So that's what Article 8 is about.
No harm.
It's on there just in case we need it. And hopefully we'll have a straight answer by then. Because right now we got mixed answers from the same department.
Okay. So that's the special town meeting where we will go over this in more detail and vote some of these that we think or that do need our recommendation.
Do you want input on Article 2?
I'm sorry?
Do you want input on Article 2?
I'd rather just do them all together if we can. You mean the 57?
The only thing I wanted to state was that this is for this year. We're getting nothing for the year before,
right,
which we asked about last year.
Sure.
I would like to say, what about giving us the money? You got the extra money in your fund. Why not give it to us? Because they're trying to save $100,000 and buy a new ambulance a year early. They've got the fund where they could pay the town of Deerfield, and they should pay us. And all they have to do is turn around and vote the $57,899 for 1 year and put a second one in for 2015 and say 90% vote required, because that's all they have to do.
Okay.
So that's my point. We asked about it last year. They blew us off. Our representatives on that board didn't do their job. If they did their job, then it wouldn't have been done, but it's not done.
Okay. Let me ask, Doug, would we have the ability to calculate what the number for FY15 for indirect costs would be? We know we have the formula. Would we have the data to calculate it?
Sure.
Okay. And do you agree that it would be the case that it would just require a 90% vote, but otherwise could be handled in the manner that...
But the other two towns have to vote it also.
Okay.
So all three towns have to have the same articles to vote it as an outdated bill.
Right. Okay. All right. I don't want to go too much into that right here, but I will say, just because we're bringing it up, and maybe we can do a quick poll again of how people feel. I'm of the opinion that I'm willing to move on from the FY15 indirect costs. I do understand Jack's position. It was discussed that it would be paid. It was not paid. For me, this is more of a turn the page thing. I think that there are large questions about South County EMS, their budget, their future, that do need to be addressed and answered. And my personal opinion is getting the $57,899 for FY16 is important, and we're going to be able to do that. I personally feel okay with moving on from that, understanding that you do have a good point. It was brought up. It was talked about.
My only point is that they should have budgeted something. They should have paid it. The town of Sunderland actually sent in a check for $12,000 for part of their share, but the town never billed them.
Right, and I think part of that responsibility...
And you know, what are we going to do? Look away at, $57,000, let's throw it away. We don't need it.
Well, it's not $57,000. I think the numbers, and I'm guesstimating here, would probably be $25,000 to $30,000 for FY15, of which 50% we'd be paying ourselves. So we are talking about the town of Deerfield could or would be entitled to...
entitled to something.
12,
like
000.
I told them last year. Put in a budget figure of 25 or 35,000. At least it's something. That way we're killing the issue. It's not going to come up and haunt us later on. Nobody ever put in for it.
Is this something that we can bring up tomorrow night?
Absolutely.
And and just let Board of Oversight deal with this issue.
Yeah.
Because they should.
And that's exactly what I want. I want them to deal with it.
Yeah.
Well, the Board of Oversight deal with it, though? I mean, part of the responsibility, you know, the town of Deerfield,
right,
unfortunately, we did take a year and a half to come up with the indirect formula. If we had come up with that sooner, this would have been done.
Mm-hmm.
So I do, that's why, part of me, I do think the town has some of the responsibility.
What do you mean we?
We, the
not
town,
the
of,
town
Deerfield.
Of Deerfield.
We, the town of Deerfield.
The Board of Oversight had that responsibility, not the town of Deerfield.
Well, my understanding is the three town administrators with the fiscal agent leading the way were in charge of coming up with the indirect formula.
That's after the Board of Oversight assigned them to do it.
Okay. You may be right.
The Board of Oversight had that responsibility in their contract.
Okay.
They're supposed to look at it every year, and they're supposed to budget it every year. They didn't do their job. The Board of Oversight, not the three town administrators. When they finally realized that they weren't getting nothing done, then they decided to push it off onto three town administrators.
Okay. You make a good point. I see where you're coming from, and we can certainly talk about this tomorrow.
I prefer not to throw $25,000 or $30,000 away. That's all it is, pure and simple.
Right.
So we can talk about it tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Can anything be added to these warrants, Doug?
They probably already
at this point, the only way that the warrants can be added is if they're reopened by the Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
Okay, so tomorrow's conversation will include that. All right, there's a couple of warrant articles on the regular town meeting warrant that I'd like to cover tonight to make sure we get to tonight. The first one, I believe, and Doug, maybe it's been changed, is OPEB. Is there still the article to fund $50,000 for OPEB?
The article just asks whether or not there will be funding for OPEB.
Okay.
Which article is that?
I'm looking it up right now. Other post. Article 19. The article simply reads, to see if the town will vote to raise, appropriate, transfer from available funds, otherwise provide any sum or sums of money for other post-employment benefits, liability trust fund, or take any action relative thereto.
So do you know if they're going to put a figure in there?
We have a figure in our budget.
Right.
50. The OPEB figure is 50,000.
Okay.
In the absence of information telling us what else to do, at least it's a placeholder, at least it's dollar amounts.
So is this something that this will be on the warrant every year and you just either will vote an amount or zero?
If it's going to be on the warrant every year, then it may turn into a budget. But for now, it's going to stay an article, separate article.
All right. Well, how do people feel about OPEB funding for this year?
I think we need to start.
Okay. I think we got to start. The question is how much we start with. Mm-hmm. And most towns are starting with the principle that we're going to do it, but they're not going hog wild with 50,000. Mm-hmm. They may turn around, put in a figure of 1,000 to start it or 5,000 to start it, but they don't go 50,000.
Okay.
It needs to be funded, obviously. I mean, it needs to be addressed. There's no question about that. But I agree, same thing. You know, I don't think we need to do 50,000 to start off with. This just to get it on board and
just get on board and vote it
right,
and put in some nominal amount, whether 1,000 or 5,000, but I don't think we need 50.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think as far as borrowing is concerned, it needs to show that we've done the accrual and we need to have a line item to
correct.
Put amount of money into the budget.
That's one thing the auditors are looking for, to see if we're starting the process.
Yeah.
Just a vote to start it is a vote in the right direction.
Which has been done. The account is there, so we did that last year, right? It's not funded, but the account
So now the question is we can turn around and put something in there and show we're working in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I would feel comfortable with $10,000 figure.
You're generous.
Well, we've got to move at some point in time. I feel a little uncomfortable jumping the gun with 50,000 unless there's a very specific reason for it.
As long as you're willing to compromise, I agree with you.
My personal opinion for this year for OPEB is I'd recommend zero.
Did we already vote this last year? I don't remember that.
No money was appropriated.
No money was appropriated.
But did we vote the principle of it?
Yes.
Yes.
The account was created.
Okay. If the account's created, then I think we should put some money in. The question is, do you want 1,000, 5,000, or 10,000?
Well,
but
I think 50 is out of line. Zero?
So the reason that I'm recommending zero is, number one, I think there's considerable lack of clarity, at least from my perspective and what I've tried to find, in terms of what our number actually is, what that represents, what we intend to do with money we put in that account.
That's the biggest question.
So, you know, for me, no plan, no money is kind of in the back of my head when I look at any of this stuff. And I understand $1,000 is only $1,000, but you know what? I'd rather appropriate the $1,000 to the library or the accountant or any of the other budgets that we had to cut tonight. And I'd rather fund those budgets higher than fund this account. I think that, and you know, I don't know, and I haven't gotten a good answer of if you know, rating agencies or potential bonding agents or whoever are looking at our fiscal position, does it matter if we have an extra $50,000 in free cash or stabilization versus the OBIP account? That's another question I don't have an answer to.
Carolyn has checked into this quite a bit. Should we hold this till tomorrow night and ask her those questions?
Well, right. They brought in a company that does this last year.
They're going to do it every couple of years.
They do it every 3 years, I believe. It's going to be done this coming year, right, Doug? Is it getting done again this year? Right.
And the figure they come up with
was huge.
They do an analysis of every employee, what they're getting paid now. They assume they're getting a certain pay raise every year. Mm-hmm. They assume they're going to work until their maximum age. Mm-hmm. And whatever the growth is, they assume that you'll get growth in there. Mm-hmm. So the figure that OPEB comes up with, this study committee, is the maximum you ever see. Now, whether it's $1 million or $1.5 million, it doesn't mean we're going to start dumping money in left and right, because it's like the Franklin Regional Retirement System. That system they had till 2028 initially to figure out and fix the thing. Then they changed it to 2033. And I'm not sure if they changed it again to, they were talking about changing it to 2050-something. And what happens is, if they've got all the time for Frank County Retirement to square away all the stuff that they have to do, what's the rush that we got to have this done in 3 years or 5 years? We don't have to.
Well, and the other concern I had from the report is those reports assume that you don't hire any more workers, or that if you do hire any more workers, that those are being pre-funded as to their OPEB liability, so you're not incurring any more unfunded liability. Mm-hmm. My concern about this from a big picture approach is 20 years down the road, whether it's towns or municipalities or whatever entities under this program are going to start to have these large accounts invested in whatever, and hoping that the earnings from those things will minimize and mitigate the amount of money they have to put towards them. And I think that's a problem we already see in the pension system, mm-hmm. where, you know, to the extent that the unfunded pension liabilities are assuming 8% growth in their investment portfolios, you get a year like last year or this year where it's flat, not even down, just flat, they go backwards. And that really concerns me, because then you're going to be throwing more and more money into it and having more and more oversight over these pockets of money that, to date, we just don't have a lot of good answers on what our plan is to do with them. But I agree that tomorrow we can talk about this some more. For me, it's not a matter of degree. It's a matter of yes or no. I'm a little bit black and white on this one. Like, I understand it's more money or less, but I'm just as opposed to 10,000 or 5,000 as I am to 50. But I'm open to everybody else.
About 1,000.
Same. Not even a dollar, because there's no plan. No plan, right. No money. That's like, you know, if Tri-Town Beach and Summer Swim don't give us any feedback, then I'd recommend just haircutting the budgets by 50%. Not because I know how to run one, but because that's part, I think, of the trust the public has in department heads and individuals and groups as to how they run and how they budget. And, you know, people across the board have done a great job, I think, our department heads, of presenting and articulating their budgets. And I think the gaps are smaller than they were last year, and hopefully will be even smaller again next year. But OPEB to me is not, I haven't heard a clear plan articulated other than let's throw $5,000 at it. And I think there's a lot of places I'd rather spend the $5,000 than that.
And like you stated, what are we going to do with that money once we put it in the account?
Right.
We're going to budget every single year the amount we need for the retirement people and so on and so forth. It's going to be in our budget.
Right.
Are we going to lower our budget by the money that's in the in there, or what?
Only once it's fully funded.
Huh?
The expectation is the best, the closest analogy I could get to what this is supposed to, how this is supposed to operate, is a scholarship fund. You build up the fund over time. You don't give out scholarships from the fund, but you build up the fund over time until you get to a point where the fund, when conservatively invested, will yield dividends equal to the amount of the scholarship that you want to give out every year, plus a little bit more. So the fund then continues to build, and you're still giving out a scholarship every year. And pretty soon you're going to be able to give out two, and then three, and then four, and so on and so forth down the line. In order for OPEB to work, the town would literally have to sock away, my crude rough numbers, somewhere between $10 and $20 million in an OPEB liability account.
Yeah.
Then that investment would yield the amount of money that we need to pay for the insurance costs for the retirees from the town.
Right.
And I, that to me is not a realistic goal under any scenario, given all the things that the town is going to need over the next 5 to 10 years to come up with, let's even use $10 million to put away.
Yeah. Right. We're already paying the retirement insurance.
Franklin County Retirement is actually building up their account. As you mentioned, they're on a pathway to 2026 or 2031 or something like that, where they will have fully funded their OPEB liability as they've calculated it. At that point, in theory, the town of Deerfield should be able to start paying a little bit less per employee for retirement costs. That's the expectation.
I'd be willing to make a projection as to if that'll happen or not.
Well, if you want to, we can make a date for 20 years from now. We'll see if you're right. But the OPEB is supposed to work the same way, but for the health insurance costs. The bigger question I think that you have to ask yourself is, how much do we currently pay for those insurance costs for our retirees every year? And how much have we paid over the course of time? Every year, what's the average? Because right now we're doing it on a cash accrual basis. We're paying out of our pocket, out of our appropriation for those insurance costs. And if you're happy with that amount, then zero this out. If you're okay to pay the $150,000 or $180,000 every year, or whatever the number is, for those insurance costs.
The problem is, once somebody retires and they're over 65, I believe they're supposed to take Medicare.
They have to.
And if they take Medicare, and then we get the retired portion as a secondary payer, I think that's only a couple of $100 a month per person. And I don't know what it is for a family.
Yeah, I don't
know.
It's
the same. It's not a family.
It's a person.
After you retire and you're on Medicare, you're on supplementary.
Supplemental.
There is no family. Right. It's single policies. And
but what do you do about the wife?
It's single. The town pays the husband and wife.
Is there like a married plus one?
No, it's married, period. You don't have anybody else.
Single or couple, right?
Single or couple.
Yeah.
And once you go on to Medicare, you don't have a family plan, because they're assuming at 65 you don't have any children under 18 to start off, or 26.
Unless you adopt some.
Well, you can go on Social Security at that point, but you need supplementary insurance. And the only thing that's really available to you is, you don't want to pay for a full policy once you retire, and you're eligible for Medicare.
Right.
So you have the supplementary.
It's a Medicare supplement policy that the town buys, and the retired percentage is 50%. The employee pays 50%, and the town pays 50%.
Correct.
So the question is, what's that costing us now for all of our retired employees that we have?
It was $287 for two.
Yeah.
So that must be the single.
Can I pull this out of the weeds? Sorry.
$188 per month for two people. It's $144 per person.
If the municipalities start funding this thing and the money in there actually gets big enough, I remember when Dukakis was governor, he fought for a year trying to get his hands on municipal retirement funds back then. You know, the state looks at that as a cash cow.
Okay, I'd like to, so we'll table voting OPEB. We will have our conversation tomorrow and plan to vote it next Monday at our next meeting.
Yeah.
The next one, and this actually is back on the special warrant, I'd like to hopefully vote here, is the energy loan payoff. I know our budget isn't final, but I think we're getting close to the end where I'd hope that all of us.
If we have the funds, I still would prefer to pay it off.
Okay.
If we have the funds. If we don't have the funds, that's another issue.
Well, what we have the funds is kind of a important question, because we literally do have the dollars, but to the extent we want to set aside certain amounts, then maybe we don't.
Right. That's why I say.
Okay. So do you want to wait until we see where we get to? I feel comfortable at this point, even if it means we're going to have a lower free cash number than I would prefer to have, I still would rather pay it off and move forward with that.
Depends on how low it gets.
Well, we saw where it was based on our budget before we made some lower recommended amounts. Even if every recommended amount was put through and we only had And then let's say we didn't put 100,000 in stabilization, that will leave us with 368,000 in free cash, assuming you paid off the energy loan.
What 100,000 in stabilization?
In the initial budget that Doug handed out, that had the 268,000 in free cash at the bottom, that assumed putting 100,000 into stabilization.
Why would we put 100,000 in stabilization?
That was just what was in there. We haven't decided to do that yet. That was the budget.
I argued against this for years.
Sure.
Where we had town administrators that would keep telling us, you got to put 25,000 every year into that stabilization. I said, at that point, we had over $1 million in there. We got 1.9 million in there now. Why do we need another 100,000? The problem is the richer you look, the more the state wants to give you less.
That's fair, and I think that's part of the conversation this year has been, is it harder to fight that battle with stabilization dollars or harder to fight the budget battle with free cash dollars, right? I think that's kind of the push-pull on that. But I'd like to table that till we get to the end because we're not talking about stabilization not right now. Basically, the budget that we presented with this morning, assuming that every recommended amount was voted through and not putting anything into stabilization, would leave us with $368,000 in free cash, assuming we paid off the energy loan. So that would be where we'd be left.
All right.
What's the amount of the loan?
$275,700.
What?
$275,700.
And Doug, you confirmed that there wasn't one more payment to be made in FY16?
Correct.
Okay.
So that's the balance of the loan?
Yes.
The $275,700 we would have to pay off in May, I think. It's either May or June,
right.
Which is why it's also on special town warrant.
Right. Anyone have any strong opinions?
You could either pay it using free cash. You could also pay it out of the stabilization fund.
Okay.
And if you pay it out of the stabilization fund, and if you don't add anything into the stabilization fund, then you bring your free cash level up to the $700,000 that Mr. Pachorek is asking for.
That's a nice move.
And you'll have that $700,000 until June 30th, and then it goes away. You can't touch it.
Right.
Until it gets recertified sometime in October.
All right. Well, then I'd like to make a motion to recommend paying off the energy loan. And at this point, not directing source of revenue, as Doug just laid out,
right. Kind
of an interesting option we may have, depending on where numbers shake out. We can make that determination in one of our subsequent meetings. But at least leading into tomorrow's, like to have our position as a committee on moving forward with paying it off one way or the other, based on what we know right now with the budget.
I'll second your motion.
Thank you.
Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right. Unanimous. Doug, is it worth discussing Montague legal defense tonight, or should we just discuss that tomorrow?
I can tell you only what I know about it.
Okay.
Montague is involved with a case as an intervener with the Department of Public Utilities. While slightly connected to the issue surrounding the pipeline, the proposed Northeast Energy Direct pipeline, in this case, the parties are the state of Massachusetts, the Commonwealth, and Berkshire Gas, amongst others, I believe. I think it's more than one gas company. Essentially, what they're trying to do is get to the bottom of why Berkshire Gas declared a moratorium on new gas connections. It is the opinion of Montague and other parties that the moratorium is a false, it was a false act, that it was done to try to curry favor for the proposed pipeline.
Okay.
Appropriation being requested is to assist in that legal effort. Montague is spearheading it as an intervener. There are a number of other towns that are supporting that effort to help pay the legal expense related to that fight. If in fact they're successful, and if the moratorium is overturned and new connections of gas are enabled, that creates a distinct, it definitely can encourage commercial development. There are at least two separate developments that I'm aware of, and I'm sure many others that I'm not, that are stalled or are not happening because they can't get natural gas service. because they can't tie in, because Berkshire Gas won't sell it to them. They won't open up the line.
And what is the requested amount?
I believe the amount is $10,000.
That's what the other towns had allocated.
Conway, I think, or is it, no, Ashfield.
Northfield, and, I think Northfield did.
Northfield too. Appropriated 10,000. Yeah. I think Ashfield appropriated
yep.
five.
Yeah.
I think it's on the docket for Conway as well.
Berkshire had a plan approved by the state to put tanks in, five tanks, to cover their shortages.
And they
put one tank and then stopped hold when they got bought by that holding company.
You mean the liquefied?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It would have taken care of that.
And aren't they now owned by a company related to the pipeline?
Yeah.
Yeah.
My only word of caution on this issue is that the town of Deerfield has a suit going, their own lawsuit going, and I just wondering if we were to vote to appropriate $10,000 to the town of Montague as an intervener, could that come back to haunt the suit that Deerfield has, because my understanding was we weren't supposed to have any involvement with the intervener position.
That was the initial feedback. Maybe if the lawyer from Conway could clarify how he feels about that.
Yeah.
The one representing us, that mm-hmm. that could help us decide.
That would be my only yeah. question about that, would be a little concerned for that.
Yeah, I believe it's resolved by not mentioning the pipeline whatsoever. That it's while indirectly related to it, it really isn't about the pipeline. It's not touching
separate
on that
issue.
Legal action. It's yeah. not touching on the validity of Kinder Morgan or any of their partners or whatever to do various things. It's only about Berkshire Gas and about the natural gas moratorium. And since we're not an intervener in the case, it protects the town somewhat from the kind of administrative liability, if you will, where an intervener, I believe, I could be wrong, but I believe that they could be subject to a records request by one of the parties and would have to produce anything and everything related to that topic. We're just simply helping them to pay the bill. We're not an active participant in the suit, so we're isolated from that.
What sort of precedents are there for towns shuttling, or not shuttling, appropriating funds to other town lawsuits? It seems, I guess I'm just a little uncomfortable with the general concept having nothing to do with the particulars of the case we're talking about. Just, that seems not unusual, but
I different. Don't have an answer. I have no idea.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Has it adversely affected the businesses in Deerfield?
The moratorium?
Mm. If they were operating, it would. I mean, there aren't that many still functioning, but
I know of one case where it has inadvertently affected Deerfield. I'll tell it to you, but not on camera.
Mm. Okay. I was just curious.
Yep.
If someone had come forward and said that they were not, they couldn't expand their gas lines. Because once they're in there, they have to supply the gas.
Yeah, if the gas line exists, or if they're currently a customer, they're not being shut off. But if there's any change in service, or, for example, if we wanted to develop over at the industrial park and we wanted new commercial business to go in there and natural gas was part of their plan, they'd be out of luck. Or if we wanted to develop up, you know, farther up on
that
5 and 10.
Can be a
or,
problem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or even if you wanted to subdivide existing, like the old Atlantic Furniture building off of 5 and 10, if they wanted to subdivide that into multiple units, they couldn't subdivide the gas service there if it exists. Mm-hmm. That would have to get rolled into the rent, which would increase the rent, which there you are.
If they were successful in their lawsuit, would they recoup their legal costs?
I don't have an answer to that. I'm not sure.
I would doubt it. I think all that's going to do is feed the lawyer. And if they get a judgment which says that Berkshire Gas was wrong and they have to release their moratorium, that's expected
the
action that you want. And that would probably be thrown out of court at that point. But whatever you expended would just, unless five towns contributed to it and they only used 30,000 instead of 50,
right,
then you may get a proportion
right,
back.
Right. Okay. All right. You know, a lot of these are new, certainly to me, and, you know, as in keeping with what we've done in the past, I'd like discussing them, and then we can kind of to think about this a little bit. I'm sure we'll talk about that again tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Another one I'd like to bring up in a similar vein is the article on the mosquito control. I'm not sure which number that is.
Too cold out there for mosquitoes now.
Yeah, I think we just
it
took care
of it. We don't have to worry about it today.
Article 21, maybe?
They weren't yesterday.
No.
Right. So Article 21. So as described to me, and I do not know the particulars as well as Carolyn will, so she can probably provide them tomorrow, this is to appropriate a sum of $11,000.
I think that's right.
To set up a handful of testing locations to capture and test mosquitoes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. That that number may be wrong, and I believe the plan is wrong. Oh. Initially, it was to go into a mosquito-controlled district,
right?
Which was something that was set up by regional towns and so on and so forth. However, when the cost actually came in for participation in the district, it was exorbitant, twice, three times what they thought it was going to be. At the same time, they also found a company that was doing active mosquito abatement. And that's what the money is now being recommended for, not to participate in a mosquito-controlled district, although there's still the sort of organizational support for that, I guess, but to actually provide the services that would help reduce the population of mosquitoes in our area.
Are you sure that's right?
Pretty sure. Carolyn can provide more information on that tomorrow. But,
okay. Yeah. All right, well then, let's say, because that is very different from how it was presented to me pretty recently, but that doesn't mean
yeah, this is fairly recent, past week or so.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, well then let's hear kind of the story tomorrow and ask questions there. Doug, are there other ones that you would particularly like us to touch on? I've got a few, but I just want to check with you before I move on.
I'm going to really quickly just go through all of them. The first seven or eight articles are pretty much boilerplate. They're articles that you see every single year. The revolving funds, same as we've seen before. That's just reauthorization of them. Article 8 is the omnibus budget bill. There you go. Article 9 and 10 deal with wastewater. 9 is the regular funding. Right. 10 is for the Headworks project. We're still working out the details of what that will look like.
And regular funding is one combination of expense and salaries or two separate items? How do they break that out?
I'm sorry, for which article?
I'm saying Article 9 is the non-Headworks project. Is that just salary plus expense budgets combined?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And Article 10 is going to be probably just approval to borrow. Because the town of Deerfield still is essentially the control agent when it comes to the wastewater treatment facility, it's going to be approval to borrow. Regardless of how the borrowing will be paid for, we still need town meeting approval to borrow the money to do the work.
District to borrow.
We don't have a wastewater. I'm sorry. Yes, we do have a district. I'm sorry. Yes. So but we still need approval to make the loan.
For the district to take out a loan?
No.
We don't have districts.
Yeah, well,
it's
fine.
Still so, the town.
Okay,
but
so,
how the loan gets paid for is up in the air.
Right. It reverts back to Article 6.
Well, that's what I'm, so yes. That's kind of.
9 and 10 revert back to Article 6.
I don't care if it gets paid for by, gold from the Magic Goose.
Well, the reason I'm asking
like
is because that article will depend on Article 6 from the special warrant.
Is it 6?
Correct.
It may change the motion of Article 10, correct?
Right.
Yeah.
So this is speaking specifically to a situation in which Article 6 from the special passes.
Yep.
And then the town would have the ability to borrow and or pay.
Yep.
For.
Yep.
That's a. Okay.
No matter what, the Board of Selectmen can't borrow without approval.
Right.
11 is South County EMS funding. 12 is the capital projects budget, the CIPC budget. And that will be the one article, I think, that's in there for the sewer. It'll come out of sewer reserves. The few articles that'll come out of free cash. All the other items will have already been voted at special. The items that are being paid for out of the municipal building fund.
And the ambulance would be?
The ambulance is a that will likely be part of the motion for South County EMS. Mm-hmm. Yes, because that's going to be approval of the capital and operating budget, so it'll be incorporated with Article 11, I'm guessing.
Okay.
I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's where it is.
Okay.
13 is the CPC. I don't have yet the list of those projects. As a matter of fact, two applications came in today, even though the deadline was March 1st, and they've got a meeting scheduled for Thursday, so we'll see what happens there. But that schedule usually comes from the chair of the CPC committee. So, Article 14 is for Franklin Council of Governments. Standard appropriation. Article 15 is for Smith Vocational tuition, which has dropped significantly because whereas we had two or three students before, now we might have one half, believe it or not. We may be splitting tuition between us and South Hadley. So that's going to be a very much smaller amount than last year.
I don't
year.
Understand that.
Split
what's that? Parents or what?
Yes, exactly. The student is half-time here and half-time in South Hadley. That's still up in the air, though, so the appropriation will likely be for the full amount. Obviously, we're only going to pay what we need to pay, so there's that.
When are we going to get the figures that go in here? When are you going to write up that?
Tuesday, next week. I'm working on
the motions.
Okay, on the motions now.
Okay.
Yeah. Article 17 is the reserve fund. That's an $80,000 standard. 19 is, I'm sorry, that was Article 17. Article 18 is the triennial recertification. That's a standard appropriation every year as well. Article 19 is OPEB. Article 20 is, you've already talked about, 21 you've talked about. Article 22 includes the schedule of elected and appointed officers of the town, and you'll notice that the requested amounts for selectmen is what was requested from the, in the budget. If the lower amount is what is voted, then this will be changed accordingly. I think I've already got the recommended amounts in there, 2,500.
Well, you knew how we were going to shake out on that one, huh?
Kind of had a feeling. Article 23 basically is a wrap-up article for the financial items. That basically says that all the funding is contingent on cherry sheet and other state funding. Article 24 is to allow the release of certain parcels owned by the town and to allow them to be sold. There's at least three parcels that we're looking at. I'm sorry, I could be wrong on that. But we're looking at anywhere from three to four parcels of town-owned land that we want to release, that we want to be able to sell. This is money that will come back into the town as free cash and really should be put into some kind of mechanism to preserve that money, to be spending it on capital projects, whether that's the rehabilitation of buildings or the purchase in accordance with a capital investment schedule. But as we sell those properties, we really need to make sure that we're doing that. That is actually according to state law. That's what we have to do.
Okay.
So.
We have to do that?
I believe so. Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry to stop you. We're getting towards 9:30. I'd like to vote a few more, or at least get some feedback on a few more numerical, actual numbers on budgets, some of which you just kind of went over.
Okay.
Would that be okay? And we need to do exactly what you're doing. I just would rather pick that up next week because I'd like to, we're getting late and I'd like to do a few more. So I'd like to start with just a few of these easier ones and then have kind of one tougher conversation to close the night. Can we discuss the unfunded sick leave vacation? So that was 10,000?
Did we discuss it?
We have not discussed it yet. I'm discussing it right now, yeah. So this is in your budget packet. It is in the back with the warrant articles. Unfunded sick leave vacation of 10,000. This is the same as the last couple years. If anyone does not have any particular reasons, I'd like to go ahead and get a motion to recommend this amount or recommend this article.
What's it for?
When a person leaves town or leaves employment in the town, and if they have any sick or vacation time still owed to them, it's paid for out of this account. Technically, it could be paid for out of the budget for that department, but that would also mean that if someone is leaving and they're immediately being replaced, that would result in an overage in that department.
But I think we've had this for years now.
It has been in there for years, yes.
$10,000, I'll make a motion, we approve that.
Seconded.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. The next one is the reserve fund.
$80,000
staying the same.
And if we need more, we can go to the special town meeting next year and get it.
Okay. Any other comments on this one?
I make a motion.
Thank you.
I'll second that.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Assessors triennial recertification. This one is a little bit higher than last year. Doug, do you have any backstory on the increase?
The increase is what was recommended. The understanding is that that's what the expenses are going to be. They're anticipating a slight increase in the cost of the services.
It's the contracted,
way
right?
by which this is done every year still confuses me, because it used to be that we had to appropriate into this fund every year, because the recertification was only done every third year. And so instead of having to appropriate $60,000 once every 3 years, they appropriated $20,000 over the course of 3 years to spread the hurt out, so to speak. My understanding, though, is that there's $50,000 or $60,000 in this account already, and we're only expecting to spend $20,000 this coming year. Okay. So I don't understand the overall funding mechanism or the overall expense schedule, more to the point. How much are we going to spend and when? I don't know yet. Okay. I think
that's
a question.
Do you know how much was spent this year?
It was something like 17 or 18,000 so far this year. Mm. We appropriated 20. We're close to that. But if we're appropriating the same amount that we spend, then why is there money left over in the fund for recertification? Right. What's it doing?
So this is one I'd like to get some more clarity on before we vote, but I just wanted to go over that because I think that's important. Next one I'd like to do is a FERCOG assessment. This amount is $43,701. It is a little over 2% higher from last year. Obviously just an assessment we're given. Doug, any kind of perspective on this number? Or
it's a slight increase.
Services we're getting. You know.
It's just the base assessment. It allows us to take advantage of the cooperative purchasing and the other baseline services through the COG. We pay an additional amount for certain other regional services that are used, the planning services and so on and so forth. But
So what does this pay for?
This pays for basically the membership fee for the COG, but we take advantage of the cooperative purchasing through them. They handle the RFPs for sand, salt, road materials, all of that.
You think it's paying for itself in the amount that we're saving over the course of the year?
I don't know. I really don't know.
Fair. You get all the good answers at 9:45.
Does it save the town work? Yes. Because otherwise we would have to be issuing either RFPs for these materials, or we'd have to be doing research into state contracts as to where we could buy this material and how. So it saves a great deal of administrative time. So,
all right. I think which is
money.
And time is money. Yeah.
I think this makes sense. It's obviously FERCOG costs are not cheap, but I do think we're getting something here. And
about 10 years ago, it used to be $10,000 higher. And they've held the cost to no increases for several years now. Mm-hmm. And this is the first year they're going up like 2%.
Well, it looks past years have been higher.
Yeah, 2015 something went on. I don't know why that one jumped up there and then back down.
We must have used it for something. Or planned to use it for something.
Well, there were back-to-back 10% increases, and then last year they dropped it 21%. So I don't, I'd like to hold off on this one, actually. That's enough of a noise in that number year over year that let me take a look at that and I'll report back. All right, I want to do three more quick ones. Smith Voc tuition.
Smith vocational tuition, it dropped from 52 down to 17. We went from 3 students to 1 full-time.
Right, was cool. 17 even?
17,556 is what it should be.
So 17,556 for Smith Voc. Anyone doesn't have any questions, I'd like to entertain a motion for that one.
So moved.
Seconded.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right. Smith Voc special education.
What number are those?
These are in the warrants. They're not in the handout I have, unfortunately. So
I'm, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. You don't have these?
No.
Oh, I apologize.
One.
Okay.
It's Article 15.
Yeah, Smith
it's
Vocational
article,
Sped tuition for the FY17 is $2,800, and the transportation, $12,600. I don't know that that is an absolutely accurate number on transportation. It will likely be lower, but I'm not sure yet.
$12,600.
$12,600.
And what were the previous years for those two items?
The previous years was $16,200 for transportation and $41,900 for Sped.
$41.90, you mean?
$4,190.
Right. $41.90,
sorry, yes.
It's $2,800 this year?
Yes.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah, so all these costs are down as there's fewer students. Anyone like to make a motion on the Smith Vocational Special Education budget of $2,800? Thank you, Ralph, and seconded by Mary. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And then moving on, Smith Folk Transportation. Anyone like to make a motion for $12,600?
Make a motion.
Thank you. Any second?
Seconded.
Thanks. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
I'm assuming those are all unanimous.
Did we do the special
yes,
ed?
They were. What's that?
We didn't do the special ed, did we? The 28?
We did.
Oh.
That was the first of those last two we did. Okay. The two last budgets there are to be discussed tonight, and I want to check everyone's energy level here. We have wastewater treatment, salary and expense, and South County EMS. I feel like South County is going to be a conversation tomorrow and a vote next week, unless anybody else would like to push strongly for something. But I am open to having a discussion so that we can be ready for our conversation tomorrow night, if people would so like. Wastewater. Now, that did that wastewater expense, how much did that change, Doug? You just handed that one out, right?
It increased from the previous, I think it was like 320 or something like that. Is that what you have?
I'm sorry?
In your book, the expense for wastewater, what did you have there initially?
Wastewater expense. So it was... going on here. It was 345,965.
Okay.
And now it's
432.
Much higher. Here's two.
Thank you.
So let's hand these out. This might just happen.
I was going to say, I don't have it.
Yeah.
There's one more. There you go.
So this seems to have changed enough that I'd like to have a conversation, so I'm just going to pass this out. The one that I would like to revisit, if Doug has this one amended, is the salaries. The wastewater treatment plant salaries, the only thing we were waiting on was the FY16 rates for the two operators. Did
yep.
we sort that out?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Thanks to Kevin and going through the numbers, we did sort out those rates. Two staff members in FY16 were operators.
Salaries, it's not
one was at grade two step eight.
All the way in the back.
One was at grade two step six. The grade two step eight was 41,822. The grade two step six was 38,482.
Okay, so just to refresh, this is confirming that the two salary increases are single step increases for the two operators within salaries. The
correct.
Budget request did not change. It was the 16 numbers that were wrong that Doug confirmed
yep.
was the problem.
Yep.
So the requested amount has not changed of 240,146.
Shows an increase of 0.43%
right.
over FY16.
It's what?
Which is odd, but that's how that's working.
241,46 in the
year. Oop, 240.
146. Would anyone like to make a motion to move that budget request of 240,146?
I will.
Thank you, Ralph. Any seconds?
I get off that number.
Second.
I don't have the right number.
240. All right. It's been made and seconded. All those in favor of a wastewater treatment plant salary budget of $240,146.
Say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Unanimous. Late for all of us. All right. Well, thank you for that push, guys. That checks a lot of those boxes. The expense one we'll look at probably next week. We can ask some questions tomorrow. South County EMS is the last thing, item to discuss, the second last thing to do before we go. What sort of conversation would people like to have tonight in preparation for tomorrow? I will start by saying that at this point, I believe I am supportive of the existing South County budget request. I still think there's a lot of things to be desired of the way the budget may look next year, and I still do have concerns, but I think it is an improvement, and I think that the reduction in assessment is commensurate with at least taking steps in that direction. I know not everybody shares that view, but that's my view, and anyone else can jump in or not.
I still think they're high. I still think that they're acting, for example, in operating reserves, 10%. we've got a school system that's over $10 million, and they got to live within a $400,000 or $500,000 E&D account. Meanwhile, we're going to leave $100,000 sitting in there. I don't think that's fair or right. I don't think it's fair that they're not willing to pay us for 2015 for some figure, regardless of what it is. And I think they're premature on wanting to buy their ambulance, and the only reason they want to do it is because they screwed up and put too much money in the budget. So to me, I think there's a room in this budget to drop it down $100,000 or $200,000 without any question, and still have way too much money.
So would you say then the easiest way to accomplish that, and maybe Doug would have an opinion here, would be to request, what would we do? Request additional retained earnings be used for the budget, or how would?
Yeah.
Is that something that, Doug, what would you say on that front? To the extent we wanted to recommend a lower budget, or would we even get to that level of detail, or just pass a lower budget and they figure it out?
To the extent that if you wanted to recommend a lower budget, you can either recommend a lower dollar amount. You can offer recommendations as to where, how they would achieve that lower amount. Basically.
Okay.
You can do one of the two things. The bottom line is you vote a different bottom line.
This is the budget paper that I'm looking at, which basically says SCEMS fiscal year 2017 proposed use of retained earnings. And they have fiscal year 15 certified retained earnings, $502,973. Proposed expenditures, $57,899 to pay Deerfield for doing the administrative thing. Operating reserve, 10% of operating, $100,000. I propose to reduce that to $50,000. Capital purchase for the ambulance. We put in $51,000 for 2 years, put in $51,000 for next year, and reduce that amount. And I know they're going to say no, but that's okay. I'd rather argue with them, because no matter how much you give them, they always want more. And the bottom line was, if they had $500,000 left over last year, what do you think they're going to have if they start off with a $100,000 reserve? You're going to have another $500,000, or it's $550,000 to $650,000.
I thought they were taking $100,000 out of the retained earnings.
If you take a look at what we have for figures for expenditures from the three quarters of this year, and you look in their, I got too many papers here now.
Can you actually go over the numbers that you just said? I apologize. I wasn't tracking it. You said starting with 502.
502,973.
Pay the indirect costs of 57.
899.
Yep.
The operating reserve is 100,000.
Change that to 50,000.
I propose to cut that to 50.
Yep.
The ambulance, hold it off for 1 year as they proposed, and just put in 51,000 in addition to the other $251,000 appropriation. That gives them
153,000. Okay.
And then reduce that by the take whatever the difference is and add it to the operating offset, which they did put in the budget. They put in the budget 60,074 to offset it already. But I don't think they need a new ambulance right now. They said they were going to buy in 2018. What's the big rush now? Just because they want to blow money?
Okay, so just so I've got this straight, starting with the 502,973. Subtracting 57,899,
yep.
Subtracting 50,000, subtracting 153, I wind up with 242,074. You're suggesting using that to offset the expenses for FY 17.
Yeah.
242,074. Where did we put that?
I do agree with John that I think a lot of people are upset with the amount that was retained, and from what I've been hearing, there's several people that have addressed that as far as the budget and the dollar amount, And I guess I kind of agree with John as far as reducing the dollar amount, with the understanding that if money is really needed, they can always come back to the towns, and that's an option. So I know they're in the second year and saying, well, it's a three-year feel-out plan. That I understand that, but to carry that much money from year to year, it appears at the moment that's being over budgeted. So I'd just soon reduce that budget, and if need be, if they need additional money, come back to the towns and ask for it. And it's kind of a check and balance situation.
If I may interject, 242074 as offset, the operating budget still remains at 1077299.
I don't understand that either, because if they started at 1100 and
operating, but I'm looking at something.
1129 something.
Might be out of date.
If they took $132,000 or $142,000 out of there, should be in a $900,000 figure. Well, it's not. It only dropped $60,000. I don't get how their math. I just don't follow.
I believe the $140,000 number is not incorrect, but it's wrong. I think that represents the operational and capital requests from last year to the operational, and then there's no capital request this year. I didn't check the math, but that was the only thing I could come up with that looked
like. There is no capital request for this year.
Right.
Do you know how much money they have in their account right now with 9 months of this year gone? They still have $866,000.
They have 3 months yet to go.
I know.
So take $250,000 out of that.
Yeah, 250. Right. So you know what you're down to? You're still over $500,000.
That includes the retained earnings of $502,000.
So they still have a balance of like $390,000-some-odd.
Closer than I can figure, they're still going to have $400,000 to $500,000 in reserve from this year.
I think the biggest challenge for me to this budget is from a long-term perspective, I think they honestly should have been requesting capital this year. If they have a capital plan, it should be in every year. And so if they do that and then lower the operational budget, I think we're going to get back to the operational budget you're looking for, and the assessment's going to be the same. That's kind of why, for me, this kind of bottom line number.
I don't like it. You don't like it. Nobody likes it. That's their accounting system that they have, and I'm just not happy with their accounting system. The bottom line is they should have, like we run a town with the so much for capital and so much for operations and everything else, and everything's detailed out.
Well, and the concern that we had last year is that if given enough capital, or if given enough resources year over year, they'd grow into them. And you do see the operational budget expanding by, you know, $57,000. So that is certainly a concern I share. With you guys. Would anybody else, like between Bill and Mary and Ralph, what are your guys' thoughts on this?
I'm concerned about the retained earnings being as much as it is, because last year we were talking about, we didn't know how much we were going to be spending, so we had to have some money in the retained earnings. This year I think we have a much better idea of what we're going to spend. They're talking about getting the new ambulance. They're all out of date. You know, so that isn't really an issue, I don't think. But they still need to put the $51,000, what they put aside every year, for another one, right?
So, yeah, actually, that's a question. So, Doug, is it still the case that the plan is to create a separate capital fund in the fall, so that going forward there would be separate pockets? Okay.
Yes.
Which doesn't affect us here, but no. Just...
The expectation, I think, is to create a separate capital fund, capital stabilization, specifically for South County EMS, and to take the $100,000 of retained earnings and put it in there.
To seed it, yeah.
To seed it. And they're replacing radios. They're replacing other capital gear that wears mm-hmm. out.
Right.
Gear that has a lifespan of 5 or 6 or 7 years, but gear that they didn't get brand new when the service was started.
Right.
They're relying on equipment that was left over from Sunderland and Whately.
Right.
So in addition to putting aside, by rights, it should be $60,000 per year for a 5-year ambulance schedule replacement. They want to put aside $30,000 or $40,000 a year for other capital. I'm guessing that they're looking to build a capital nest egg, if you will, for those operational items, the radios, the stretchers, things like that that wear out but that are $12,000 and $15,000 and $20,000 items. They want to take that money, have it available. But once they get up to $60,000 or $80,000 into that, they'll feed it more slowly. Only, you know, as it's needed, as expenses come through. But the $60,000 a year for the ambulance is appropriate given the replacement schedule.
Ralph and Bill, I'd just love your guys' thoughts, like on their requested amount. You know, obviously we're still going to learn more, so you may change your mind, but you kind of leaning towards, you feel that number makes sense? You feel that number's too high? Where are your guys' heads at?
I have listened, I feel like, all year long to discussions about South County. Back when this this whole idea started, I was involved. I've been to all the meetings. I've listened to the same talk over and over. I know new people like you, Dylan, have kind of got caught up with information more recently. But all of this is like old history to me. I despise the fact that there's all the hearsay and the animosity and the mudslinging and et cetera. The pressure, the tension, all for nothing, because I don't think there's any one bad person involved. I think everybody has absolutely good intentions. I don't think there's a deceitful town or deceitful people out there trying to do anybody in. I think everybody really wants a good ambulance service, improved over what we used to have. I think there were good intentions. I think there's a lot of misunderstandings. John has incessantly brought this up. He's had notes. He half the time can't find his notes. If anybody felt so strong about this budget is not correct, why isn't it that I don't see two PowerPoints put up here where this is what they said, this is what somebody here thinks it should be, something that's clear, something that can be printed on a piece of paper that shows point by point. But oh no. We grab a piece of this.
Right, Ralph, throw
Ralph,
it out. I'm really
all right,
interested.
Okay,
in,
then. All right. Okay, then. I'm all done.
No, I'm interested
done.
In what you
I'm
think.
All done.
Yeah. I'm not interested in what you think of what other people think in this instance.
Okay.
I appreciate where you're coming from, but do you understand
then
why?
Scratch the whole thing.
Why
I'd like I approve
to,
the budget just the way it is. That's it.
And that's a all fair done. Position. Is that your position, or you just don't want to talk about it anymore?
No, you just interrupted me, and so
well because
I'm
you're not
stopping.
Because you're not talking about what you feel and believe. You're
okay.
talking about what somebody else.
All right, I'm
do
all.
You, do you support?
I support the budget as it is. Period. All done.
Okay.
Ask Bill now.
Okay, Bill.
I don't think. I think they flew too much from the cuff forming this thing, and some basic, you know, they could have gone to UMass and got an accounting student to help them set this up at the begin with so that it made sense. But there was at least the mindset of a few of the members of that Prudential group, if we make the pot of money big enough, then we'll get through this first 3 years.
The Prudential group, you mean the oversight board?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
And because of that, it was just too loosey-goosey the way it was being done. And that's where, you know, there's a lot of money still floating there. And I, you know, the accounting of it wasn't very good. We tried for 14 months to get them to figure out their formula so Deerfield could get a little bit of reimbursement. It shouldn't have taken that long.
So, you'd still be looking for additional reductions in the FY17 budget?
Yeah.
Not set in stone, but that's kind of where you're feeling.
Yeah, the ambulance service needs to pull back and kind of realize they've got three towns that are hurting for funds, and you know they just aren't going to be able to throw all that money at them.
Okay. All right, well, I know it's been the end of a long night, and there's...
I have to ask the question, I'm sorry. Sure. Do people sitting at this table feel that $1 million for a 24/7, 365 service such as this is out of the range of what should happen?
Absolutely not.
From what I'm seeing at the moment, with the retained funds for the last couple of years that they've had, I think it's a little overfunded. I'm not saying, and I want everybody to understand, this has nothing to do with the service itself or the people involved. I think there's a ton of respect out there for the people involved in the service that's being done. I think it basically comes down to what the towns can afford. And from what we've seen so far, it looks like there's a little overfunding of this budget. Also, let's not forget that it's not just this $1 million that we're talking about. At some point in time here, we need to find a home for the ambulance service. And that's going to add to the budget already existing. That's additional monies. I don't care if you bond it or borrow or whatever you want to do with it. That's additional monies coming out of people's pocket. And it's the same pocket, and the pockets are only so deep. And it comes down to what the town can afford. And I think that's, as far as a finance committee, I think we have to oversee that. And as I said, there's always a solution to this. If there's a dire need for the something to do with South County, they can come back to the towns and ask for it. And that's my feeling on it.
So if there's a dire need, they would come back to the towns, and all three towns would have to hold town meetings and reappropriate money.
Yeah.
Town of Deerfield would have to hold a town meeting to readjust the budget.
It could be done at an annual town meeting, Doug, and we've been having special town meetings twice a year, three times a year here in South Deerfield recently, so I'm sure it could fit into one of those.
Okay.
I think the biggest problem's been the people that have been handling the budgets really aren't numbers people.
Right.
And that's been, from the way I look at it, that's what the biggest problem's been. And they are afraid that if they cut the budget too much, they are going to not have enough money to support the excellent service that it is.
I agree 100% with that. But in my simplistic thinking, I feel at the end of 3 years, you're going to have what you have. There's going to be extra left over, or there isn't, and the full accountability would be then on the table for all towns to look at and say, yeah, it's overfunded and there is extra, or we just don't need this and we can cut it back. But, you know, I just keep going back to the fact that they said that it would take 3 years. It's an enterprise fund. It's a plan of $1 million a year for 3 years to get to the point where the thing is fully developed, and then we know what the costs are. But I obviously am wrong.
I think one of the ways that we could possibly bring the budget down and get some of the retained earnings down would be to use some of the retained earnings to fund some of the operations, if we could do that. Can we do that, Doug?
Well, they're doing that currently.
Absolutely. Sale of the ambulance, just like Mr. Petrarch just recommended. Keep $153,000 in the capital, transfer the rest of it into retained earnings, put $240,000 into the retained earnings money, and you'll reduce Deerfield's assessment down to $200,000 next year. And you're running an ambulance service with a 7-year-old ambulance, a 12-year-old ambulance, and an 18-year-old ambulance.
Right. I'm saying after they take, I really feel that they need to purchase that ambulance before they start having a lot of breakdowns.
I agree.
Because it is becoming, you know, a lot of people think, well, 10 years, that's not very old. But in equipment like this, it is. A fire truck can go 30 years, but not an ambulance that's run every day.
Would it be appropriate would it feel reasonable that the numbers and the budgeting and it has to be a little tighter before any of us talk about bonding facilities? You know, once we lock into that, we're in.
Well, that's
nobody's talking about that.
No, I know.
There won't be a motion on town meeting floor.
Not this
year. There won't be a motion to move to a different location. There won't be a motion to appropriate money for a new facility. It's not going to happen at town meeting.
Right. And look, I think that, I guess I'm trying to be glass half full here. I think that the process this year was a lot better than last year. I mean, last 100%. Year was a disaster across the board. every time we met or talked about it from start to finish. I think, and I think the things that some of us still are uncomfortable about, we're making progress on. It's a matter of degree of progress, if it's enough progress. It's not like they're not using any retained earnings to lower the budget assessment. They are. It's just, should it be more? You know, they haven't completely articulated their capital plan, but it's more articulated than it was in the past. The staffing plans for the two ambulances is much clearer than it was a little year ago.
I was so grateful when they came out and said, we tried, we couldn't make it work. And that was good.
So, again, I'm not trying to push anybody onto my opinion here, but I do think it's important that wherever we end up, that it is recognized that it is an advance in this process, unfortunately, especially in government, is iterative and it is slow and usually slower than we'd like, much like the length of this meeting.
I think just like Mary said, that you don't have financial people controlling that.
Well, and but
they're trying to push the director along and give him pay raises like he knows what he's doing, and he puts these big figures in there, and then I turn around, I complain to Tom Feidenkiewicz the other day. I says, why are you turning around and accepting all these big figures that are put in there? He says, because the town of Deerfield gave them to us.
Yeah.
I felt very affronted by that comment, because who from the town of Deerfield is giving them all these inflated figures?
Well, I don't know specific to the numbers, but I think that as I look at this, admittedly from the outside to a large extent, as not knowing how to run ambulance service, I think it could be instructive and helpful to have a broader input on the oversight board from Deerfield representation than we've had so far. I know there's talk of adding a third member, and I think that would be helpful. And I think that, you know, it'd be interesting to get some different perspectives with that representation. And I think that's something that I plan or I'd like to bring up tomorrow. And if warranted at town meeting as well.
That's the fiscal agent?
I'm sorry?
Is it the fourth one, the fiscal agent? But you got Whately, Sunderland, Deerfield.
I'm talking about the oversight board members representing the town of Deerfield. So there was discussion of adding an additional one.
The financial.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Which I think right there would be helpful for as we're talking about having a little bit more budget expertise on there.
I think one of the recommendations that came around or one of the suggestions that was being bandied about was to request or to suggest that the town accountant for Deerfield be the fiscal agent and sit on that board.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But that seems to make a great deal of sense.
Right.
Yeah.
She doesn't get paid enough money to do that.
Well, we'll make him take in there.
Brenda's got that kind of background and structure to.
Well, it's an unknown structure.
And I think, I do think they've tried to respond in their own way in the last 8 months to the
exactly
lot more conversations back and forth.
You know, part of the excess has been from more revenues than they projected. They've moved that estimate up for this year, and if it's higher again, they'll move it up again, just like we do with local receipts, trying to trail but follow, you know, that direction until it levels off. So. It's been a long night. Oh, sorry, you were going to say something.
Oh, I think it has the ability to become a real good service.
I think it is a real good service.
I think it's a good service now, personally.
Well, I don't know what the I don't know the staffing issues.
Right.
But
there are no staffing issues. They're working to improve the service.
Huh?
They're working to make the service more responsive.
Yeah, which is excellent.
They're working to improve the response time. They're working to create efficiencies. As soon as this fiscal year is done, we're going to go back and we're going to look at the expenditures from FY16. And we may very well bring this budget back before a special town meeting in the fall to revise some of these figures and bring them more in line. Up to this point, there was no capital expenditure fund, and so all the monies go into one pot.
Right.
Which is the quota, you know, the balance, $700,000, $800,000 right now. It sounds like a lot of money. It includes $500,000 they carried over from last year. They're on target to meet their budget this year. About half of their retained earnings is because they were making more money than they expected.
Right.
That will always continue to be the case because we always conservatively estimate revenues.
Their free cash is going to bump just like
department.
The town's
right.
does.
Right. In every department.
Right.
And it sounds like a lot of money. $1 million sounds like a lot of money for one department. But because it's an enterprise fund, all the expenses related to that department have to show up on their budget. If we're looking at the administrator's office, I'll pick on this office, you're seeing $180,000, but that's not the whole expense of the office. Part of it is the housing, part of it is the benefits, part of it is the capital. The same thing is true with every other department. Even the highway, where the budgets seem very high, that's still not the full expense because there's HR costs.
It's a very good point. Very good point.
And go to any department and you're going to see that.
I'd like to close with that. The only thing I'd ask, so we're going to have our joint meeting tomorrow night. I know Mary said you're not going to be able to make it. Hopefully Skip will be able to make it. If anybody has topics they'd like to have covered, please see me after to suggest or email me tomorrow morning. I'm going to be working with Doug to whittle that down. Some of them we've picked up tonight. We know we'll pick up tomorrow. If there's others we haven't talked about, please let me know. So I'll look to see you guys tomorrow. We have our meeting scheduled for tomorrow at 6:30, so we can meet at 6:30 if anyone would like to go over things before meeting with the select board at 7, or we can just meet here at 7 and just do that. Yes.
For what it's worth, I was just going to say that we had scheduled a public hearing for 6:35, but that is canceled.
Okay. So they'd be ready for us.
So
at 6.
You're about 6:45 or so. So as soon as we can get in.
All right. So we'll plan for 6:30. We'll kind of start right off with them, and then our other next plan meeting for us is next Monday, the 11th at 6:30. We'll probably be going over the rest of these warrant articles and a couple other things that we didn't get squared away today. Anybody else have any comments?
Do we have to post a meeting?
I did.
Right. Okay.
Gotcha.
I was going to say it was a little late if we didn't.
I got you.
Okay.
Any motion to adjourn?
Oh, gladly.
Anyone?
I make a motion.
Anyone happily second?
Yes.
All right, all those in favor?
All right.
Thank you, guys. Long
what time
night.
Is it?